Galatians, the people of the United Kingdom, you have dealt a death blow against the authoritarian covert project for world government. They denied that they were even building an EU decades ago. Then they said that it was elected and wasn't dictatorial. Then they said they wouldn't restrict free speech, which they've done. The EU bureaucrats have exempted themselves from taxation. These people are classical criminals, politicians transferring the power from nation states to a multinational body where they and their families rule forever like royalty. And despite all the vote fraud, all the intimidation, all the threats by the EU, the people of the UK have said no, a huge blow against tyranny, a huge boon for liberty and freedom and sovereignty and populism worldwide. This is a great victory. Congratulations to the folks in the UK. We see nationalism rising here in the United States as well. Donald Trump has come out against world government, said this is a serious blow against globalism. Nigel Farage, Donald Trump, globally helping lead us against the New World Order. And you, the Info Warriors, spreading the word for all those years, you are the tip of the spear in this fight. You are the resistance, so congratulations to you. They can't have world government and keep it in the shadows, especially when it's authoritarian. And by forcing the debate, being called conspiracy theorists for being informed, we have now forced it into the mainstream, and we're winning the debate that we shouldn't have multinational corporations masquerading as government with diplomatic immunity above the law playing God. This is the beginning of the end of world government. It may take 5-10 years, but we have blown giant bloody holes in the globalist operation. That's why I've always said, we're on the march. The globalist New World Order empire is on the run.
Absolutely, and this is a very important day. Very excited, very happy. There's a great deal to celebrate today. And of course, we see the markets in turmoil, but don't fear. Don't worry about that. This is just a bump in the road, folks. This is something that they're pulling on us. We're going to be talking to Steve Pachinik. That's precisely what he's going to explain to you. We're also going to be talking to Roger Stone. We have another victory domestically, so we're going to talk to him about what's going on with that. But understand this in the context even of American elections. What we are involved in is a world war against globalism. Why should we believe these people who have failed to predict every catastrophe that has happened to us? They're now predicting, oh, this is going to be a catastrophe. I don't think so. We're going to get over it. It's not even a problem, and Donald Trump pointed it out. Many people, Donald Trump understands that when the currency goes down, as he pointed out, the golf course in Scotland where he was, he says, hey, it'll make it cheaper for people to come here. There are advantages to that. How do you think China got rich? Why do you think Japan is trying to manipulate their currency down? If the globalists want to try to manipulate this currency down, this is probably just a bump in the road. But if they want to keep it down to try to scare the people in Britain and leave it down, I say bring it on. We're going to look at all the different results of this. Of course, David Cameron is having to resign. We see Nigel Farage, who has worked for many, many years as a voice crying in the wilderness, finally vindicated over all of this. And there's the forces at play. People who support Trump, as well as people who don't support Trump, are pointing to the fact that this is very portentous for what's going to happen in the United States. We have an article from Paul Joseph Watson making that very case. And we have news from every source, left and right. Here's the BBC saying 5 reasons Brexit could signal Trump winning the White House. Everyone is saying that. And look at Hillary and Obama. Look at how little effect they had. As a matter of fact, I think probably Obama helped Britons to get their freedom. Do you think people really like foreigners coming into your country and threatening you, telling you you're going to get at the back of the line? Yeah, that worked really good, Obama. And you keep bringing in those people from Mexico and from Europe to threaten us about how we should not have our own control over our own government. This truly is Independence Day. I really didn't think it would happen. I was absolutely amazed that this happened. I thought, well, okay, they're showing them ahead for a little bit. Now, they're bringing in Remain now. They're going to rig this election. It must have been a massive landslide where they couldn't rig this thing. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
The developments that we have witnessed in the last 24 hours in the UK referendum to leave the euro is one of the greatest political events, not just in modern history, but in world history. The globalists for more than 50 years have tried to build a planetary, unelected world government by stealth. The problem is, once you finally try to put it into play and create global taxes and global regulations, and once you start trying to arrest people that criticize the EU or criticize open borders, people then knew that what the, quote, conspiracy theorist, that is informed individuals, had been telling them for decades was true. Margaret Thatcher, famous prime minister, in the 80s had warned that the Euro project and the Bilderberg Group were a tyrannical organization attempting to transfer power from nation states to unelected boards. And the great victory is that despite the intimidation, despite all the election fraud, despite the media, the traitor media working to deceive the people, the vast majority of voters in the UK voted to leave the European Union. Now, this isn't just a referendum on global government. It's a referendum on mainstream media and the fact that their deception isn't working on the people anymore. And yes, they're going to strike back, and they're going to drive down stocks, and they're going to play all sorts of games and try to hold countries hostage. But it doesn't matter, because the euro was set up to destroy nation states and to consolidate power and control. The euro was set up to loot nations. The founders of it from the beginning admitted. It's even been in the BBC. Paul Watson's written articles about it, that it was set up to be piratical. Their excuse is they're destroying commerce and prosperity to, quote, save the earth. The truth is they are simply consolidating power and control for themselves to carry out autocratic dictatorial controls. And this also is a major referendum showing that modern populism is based in the true worldview and cosmology of anti-New World Order, anti-globalism. And despite the media for decades saying none of this existed and that there was no plan and that there was no plan to set up a carbon tax and there was no plan to set up these global tribunals and there was no plan to set up a one world religion and the Federal Reserve was federal, it wasn't privately controlled, all of these hoaxes have fallen. And now we're beginning to have a real debate. And all the people that laughed at the conspiracy theorists, which just meant laughed at informed folks, now realize that they were chumps. They realized they were conned. They realized that they were manipulated. They realized that it really was true that the power structure would dare try to establish a corporate, secret world government. And once that genie is out of the bottle, it's all over. The globalists are in full panic, and it's happening all over the world. Here's a headline from CNN. They actually tell the truth at the first part of this article. It's very rare. UK referendum. And it goes on in the article to admit, in the single most momentous day in British politics since World War II, the impact of this result has been far and wide. The global markets hit, and UK Prime Minister David Cameron announcing his resignation after the United Kingdom voted to leave the European Union. That's right, resigning. And Nigel Farage, who would come on our shows 10 years ago, the leader of the UKIP party that was just founded a few decades ago, that went from having a few percentage points in the polls a decade ago to now being the fastest growing party, not just in the UK, but in Europe. And he gets up every week in the UK Parliament or in the EU Parliament. UKIP members do that in the UK. He does it as a UKIP member in the EU Parliament and points out that their rulings and their votes are ceremonial and that almost all laws are made by the EU bureaucracies and that it is actually a dictatorship that hands down power like the Communist Politburo in China to the successors, generally, who are even family members. I mean, think about how crazy this is, and all these weird politicians from the former Eastern Bloc that were communist are now being recruited to run the whole show. They're actually reactivating the Stasi. This isn't just an unelected bureaucracy that hoaxed its way into power. It's also anti-freedom. It's anti-religious freedom. It's anti-free speech. It's globalist. It's trying to rush in as many foreigners as it can so that they can activate them anytime they need to and have them burn down major cities if the French or the Germans or the Swedes or the Dutch or the Greeks or the Italians don't submit. I mean, this is modern warfare that we're seeing. And the incredible news is, I can't even really describe personally the words of how massive this is, because this is the globalist system basically tearing itself apart. The people know that world government is not trying to deliver some socialist utopia, but it's delivering a eugenics nightmare. We have statements up on Infowars.com by Donald Trump talking about how nationalism is winning and populism is awakening and how globalism and world government and unelected tyrannies are failing and how this is a referendum in Europe on nationalism and how this bodes well for him in the election here. Absolutely. And even if the globalists dare steal this election from Donald Trump, or God forbid, assassinate him, he'll just be a bigger martyr. He'll just be a bigger hero because he resisted, because he spoke up. And all I can say to the patriots around this world, from England to China to the United States, from Mexico to Canada, doesn't matter where you are, from Brazil to Chile, from Nigeria to South Africa, from Japan to India, from Russia, it just doesn't matter. You are humans that have common sense and want basic sovereignty and want due process and want private property and want to have fair courts and want your children to have a future. And you know the world government project of Henry Kissinger, who, by the way, just endorsed Hillary Clinton, is designed to create a permanent ruling oligarchy overclass that dominates and controls humanity and basically establishes a scientific dictatorship known as a technocracy in their own words. They're so arrogant that 6 years ago, there was an article in the Financial Times of London, and it said, and now for world government, by their foreign editor, who, by the way, has attended Bilderberg, and he arrogantly wrote in that article, you ought to read it, he wrote two different ones of the same name, because the first one was so incendiary, they tried to put this, a new one out a day later with the same headline to confuse folks, but you can go read both of them. And in the article, he says, and now for world government, he says, yes, we did this by stealth. Yes, it's authoritarian, and we have a right to rule you because we were smart enough to take over and do this. Well, it's not very hard when your large central banks that control the manipulation of currency and credit to establish a plan to create international boards where you buy off politicians and then have them, by stealth or by treaty, sign over incremental authorities into that multinational body. Then you don't even have a vote in most cases, like the UK didn't enter the EU. And then over the process of decades, you finally transfer total power, exempt yourself from taxes and regulations, give yourself diplomatic immunity, and create a new system of royalty. And its greatest power was that it was over the top. Its greatest power was that it was so ridiculous and so flagrant and so just over the top ridiculous that people couldn't believe that this was really being established and their countries were going to be ruled, never voting, by multinational corporations on secret boards that exempt themselves from taxes. No one could believe it, even though it was in all the documents, even though it was all admitted, even though it was all on record. People couldn't believe it, just like they couldn't believe the Federal Reserve wasn't federal. But once they finally are forced to see it's true, it doesn't matter how many articles they have calling us conspiracy theorists. Then the massive nature of the hoax that helped them get away with it becomes now a bomb or gasoline that burns them down that much quicker. Total hoaxes, total con games, either totally succeed or totally fail and blow up and burn into ashes. And now we're seeing this giant, rotten old barn doused in gasoline that is the world government project being lit on fire. And these globalists are going to strike back. They're going to hammer the economy. They're going to start wars. They're going to engage in all sorts of false flag behavior, you name it. But again, the genie's already out of the bottle. The trick is already exposed. People are conscious and are aware of what's happening. And we have so many, many, many battles ahead of us. But I'm telling you, this battle has helped us win the war. Just like once they turned Hitler back in Russia, and when Operation Barbarossa failed, and just like when we beat them at the Battle of the Bulge, we knew Hitler was going to continue to fight on. But he had lost the war. There was no way for him to turn the tide back the other way. And we have now passed the Rubicon, ladies and gentlemen. We've got a lot of problems to face. There's still corruption. World government will try to rear its head again and again. But we have slain the dragon with a death blow. It's climbed back into its cave and is bleeding to death right now. And I just want to salute every single one of you. This is a time to absolutely celebrate. This is something to write, put in your diary and to tell your kids about, because this is as big as 1776, ladies and gentlemen, as initiating July 4th. We haven't won the whole war yet, but I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, things have been put in motion historically that cannot be controverted, and the power of the Renaissance will not be stopped. Paul Watson's coming up. Roger Stone's coming up on Donald Trump's statements on this issue, and so much. Big broadcast. Stay with us.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this 24th of June, 2016. Mark it down. This is going to be a day like July 4th. Remember, that was not when we won the Revolutionary War. That was not when we won our independence. That was when we declared our independence, declared the right of self-government, declared that we have inalienable rights, that we create these governments to secure, that a just government governs to fulfill these rights. And when they are destructive of those rights, it's the right of the people to alter or abolish it and institute new forms of government. And that's what we're seeing happening now, the very beginning of that happening in Britain. I never thought it would happen. I never thought it would happen. I thought it was going to be rigged. And of course, Paul Joseph Watson did as well. I know I was watching his tweets and the things he was putting up in articles. I was tweeting the same stuff. It's like, okay, they're ahead right now. And say, now they've got Remain ahead. They're going to rig this election. It must have been a massive landslide for them to only win it by 4 points. Okay. That was a solid win. That was a solid win. They had 70 some odd percent of the people turn out to vote. And Watson is going to be here and give us some more details on that. But put that in perspective. We only have about 50% of the people vote in American elections. So that was a huge, huge turnout. Now, as the headlines look, one article that's really good. This was the day the British people defied their jailers. That's a Telegraph headline. Another one, Brexit, the world's most complex divorce begins. And we'll talk about all this stuff. But as I was looking at this, as I was celebrating this pushback against globalism, all I could think about was, the British are leaving. The British are leaving.
That means I'm single again. Oh, yeah. The heck?
Yeah, baby. It's Brexit. This is great. It was so much fun watching this. Yeah, looking at this parade. That is the opening of Austin Powers, if you recognize that music. And that's what we all felt like last night, watching Britain take back its freedom, take back its culture. Look. This is real multiculturalism, a free Europe where people pursue their own destiny, where they write their own laws, where they have their own culture, and it's not dictated and dumbed down to them. And when I just did the backflip into the Jaguar XKE that's covered with a Union Jack, I couldn't do that, but I had to get in the car and go for a ride with my wife last night, like 1 o'clock. It was just too exciting. Okay. So we're going to have, in the next segment, we're going to have Roger Stone with us because we do have a victory to celebrate here in America coming up with the convention in Cleveland. And he's also going to talk about what this portends for the presidential election. Everybody is saying this, left and right. Some of them are wringing their hands. Some of them are celebrating like we are. We're also going to have Steve Pachinik joining us, telling people, don't fear. They're trying to turn up the fear. Because, you know, this is not going to be an immediate process. This is going to be a long, drawn-out process. The Germans say, we want you out now. Get out. Go now. But it's going to be a couple-year process. And, of course, we've had David Cameron already resign. But he resigned and said that it's going to be a leadership change in October when the Tory party meets. And the Germans are saying, don't wait that long. Get out now. So we'll see what happens. But once that article is triggered, it's going to take a couple of years possibly for this to work its way out. And in the meantime, you're going to see what we're seeing today. You're going to see manipulations of the marketplace. I don't think Britain shot itself in the footsie, their stock index. I think that this is a manipulation. I think it's going to work itself out. And we're going to talk about why, even if the currency goes down, that can be a very good thing. Now, before we go to the next article here and talk about this, I just want to tell you about a new special we've got at InfoWars.com, because that's how we maintain our independence as a media organization. We don't want to be dependent on other corporations who are going to come in here and try to manipulate us by giving us a lot of ads, making us dependent upon them, and then pulling it out at the last minute, pulling the rug out from under our media operation. So Alex Jones has wisely come up with a plan to fund our own media operation and to provide top quality health products, as well as other things like water filters. We still have the 20% off Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. That's all of them, from the largest down to the smallest. And we got a new sale today, Deep Cleanse. This is our fastest seller. It is now in stock, 20% off at InfoWars.com. This is the Rolls Royce of all-in-one cleansers. And that's the important thing to understand. It is a all-in-one cleanser. Instead of buying 5, 6, or 7 different cleansing products, we use decades of scientific research to put this together. It combines the power of concentrated zeolites, organic cilantro, organic milk thistle, and many other cleansing ingredients. Right now, 20% off a new sale, Deep Cleanse at InfoWarsLife.com. That's what keeps us independent. It's what funds our organization. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Roger Stone. He's going to break this down and tell us about a new victory here in America. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this momentous day. It is Independence Day for Britain, as Boris Johnson said. I was looking at the Telegraph's Tim Stanley. His headline is, "This is the day the British people defied their jailers." He said, "The people defied the experts, and they went with their conscience." He said, "Labor voters, most of all the Northeast, rebelled against a century of Labor leadership." He says, "I'm astonished, staggered, humbled. I should never have lost faith in my countrymen, those bold, brave, beautiful British voters. Good for you. You're leading the way in freedom." And you know, it was Winston Churchill who said in the history of the English-speaking people, now we've written a new chapter, by the way. This is going to be a new chapter. This is going to continue in America. We're going to talk to Roger Stone about that, but this is a new chapter. And he said, when America got its independence from Britain, it was a liberating thing for Britain as well. It unleashed freedom in Britain. It gave power to the people, to the parliament in Britain. And we're going to see this happening as the EU unravels. And you're going to see true multiculturalism. You're going to see the energy and the culture of the European people, which has been repressed and dumbed down, turned into this kind of politically correct gray mass, a lobotomized population who has been indoctrinated and controlled by a central government. You're going to see that explode in creativity and diversity, true creativity, true diversity. So let's go to Roger Stone. Of course, Roger Stone has worked for many pro-American political parties in Eastern Europe. And I want to talk to him about that, but we're going to talk about a victory, first of all, that has just happened in regards to our presidential election here. Welcome, Roger.
David, great to be with you.
Did you see this coming? I got to ask you, did you really see this coming? Because I didn't. I thought the people were with it, but I thought they were going to rig the election. It must have been a total landslide for them to be able to win by 4%. I guess they figured they just couldn't swamp the votes that were coming in from the countryside by rigging it and the places that they control.
Yeah, globalism has taken two enormous hits this year. First, the rise of Donald J. Trump. And now the Brexit vote.
Yes.
Globalism is done. And the globalists are increasingly panicky about the prospects for the road ahead. I think this portends very good things about the American election. I am very pleased with the developments in the Trump campaign. I believe they can now strategically get back on track, get back on offense, because when you're not on offense, you're losing votes.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, when I looked at this, Roger, we saw this division in the UK over Brexit. You had the Labour leadership really versus the Labour voters. The Labour voters had really gotten the shaft with globalism. And yet the Labour leaders, the Labour union leaders, as well as the Labour Party leaders, were supporting staying in this globalism that had cost their voters their jobs. And then we saw the Tory leadership divided as well. Here in America, we've got the Democrat leadership, like Hillary Clinton, who was pushing, say, keep this together, and yet it's their voters, their blue-collar voters, who are being hurt by this, just like we saw in England. And then we've got the GOP establishment, and the only person on the other side of that is Donald Trump, but it's big enough that he can stand there with the blue-collar voters, I think, and with the Republican voters who understand what's going on, the people that Bilderberg was so concerned about, they called the precariat. I think they should be very concerned about that precariat. I think they should be very concerned about this, the people understanding how globalism has really screwed them over.
Yeah, I think it's a very analogous situation. I mean, ironically, it is the Democratic Party and the Clintons who brought us NAFTA. Remember what it was that Ross Perot said about NAFTA? He said that that sucking sound you hear are the jobs leaving America.
Yeah.
Of course, he turned out to be exactly right. Once again, the leadership of the Democratic Party and some in the union movement supporting NAFTA, now I think a great recognition, particularly among the Bernie Sanders voters, that these large globalist trade deals, whether it's NAFTA or TPP, TPA, they're leaving the American economy behind. So it is a precursor. I really believe at the end of the day, Trump will be able to get almost a third of the Sanders voters, not his hard left voters, but those labor-oriented voters who both opposed the Iraq war and opposed these globalist trade deals.
And who also opposed the establishment essentially controlling them, the corrupt establishment, because that was also a big part of it as well. People didn't like what was happening in Brussels, and people don't like what the establishment of both parties are doing to them. And that's a reaction that we see with the Sanders voters as well as with the Trump voters. So I agree with you. I think he's got a very strong case to make to both of them. Tell us what's going on in Cleveland now. I understand you got some new developments there.
Yeah, I mean, yesterday was kind of like the daily double. We won two important victories. Not only was I pleased about the vote in the UK, but the city of Cleveland had handed down a set of very restrictive gag orders on Trump demonstrators and Trump supporters for the days surrounding the convention. Many months ago, working with Citizens for Trump and others, we applied for a permit to have a specific march and rally outside the facility, the convention facility. The city delayed and delayed and delayed. They ultimately denied our permit. They gave one to Black Lives Matter, but they denied ours. And ultimately, they cooked up rules that would have required all protesters to be essentially in the same penned-in area. So in other words, Black Lives Matter, MoveOn.org thugs, cheek by jowl with Liberty Republicans, Trump supporters, bikers for Trump, and so on. This was an obvious recipe for fisticuffs,
yeah,
for violence. Perhaps this is what the city Democratic machine in Cleveland actually wanted. They would not give us a specific location for a rally. They would not allow us to have our own public address system. They would only allow us to have access to a system set up in a certain area controlled by the city in which you have to apply to speak. And 20 people have already been approved. You can imagine they are the Vegetarian Party, the New Agers, I mean, every kook group you can think of. So with the ACLU supporting us, we went to federal court. I'm always skeptical about the judicial system because I believe judges are essentially politicians who climb to the top of the heap.
Right.
But in any event, yesterday a federal judge threw out the city's rules, specifically directed the city to reduce the security perimeter for the convention from 4 miles away to 1 mile away.
Wow.
Which is far more reasonable.
Wow.
That in turn, I think, opens a number of city-owned sites potentially for the what was originally the Stop the Steal rally featuring Alex Jones and Ann Coulter and other speakers, and is now hopefully will be the American Unity rally and hopefully a triumphant moment for Trump supporters.
Are you still going to be confined into some kind of a cage? Because this is something that we've seen getting worse every round of presidential elections, removing people who want to speak or to protest or whatever, removing them farther and farther away, putting them in cages, restricting their ability to speak. We've seen this as an ongoing trend, and every 4 years it gets worse. But now that they have shrunk the security perimeter from 4 miles to 1 mile, are they still going to be putting you in cages and restricting who can speak and that sort of thing?
No, I don't think so. I think the judge made it very clear that none of that was acceptable. So in negotiations to settle, the city would like to settle the suit. We would like a city-designated area permit for a rally. We want a half an hour buffer before and after. And if we're a permitted activity, obviously we want the protection of the Cleveland police. Mm-hmm. It's one of the most amazing things about this process, David, is that all the time we were fighting with the bureaucrats at City Hall, individual police officers involved in this process would always take me aside and say, by the way, we're 100% for Trump.
Yeah.
And good luck with your lawsuit. I think it is likely that we will settle with the city, that we'll get a workable location. Now, of course, the city has stymied us for months in terms of getting people to Cleveland, figuring out where they're going to sleep, attracting the marshals we need to make sure that this is a nonviolent protest. So we're behind the eight ball. On the other hand, I have great faith in both Donald Trump and the Liberty Movement, and I think we will have a huge crowd. Huge crowd in Cleveland.
That's excellent. And I remember when the Bundy Ranch thing happened, everybody was truly outraged. Here this was out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, literally the middle of nowhere. It was hours north of Las Vegas. Virtually all the land was under federal control. And they had a small enclave of people that were there to protest that were maybe about a mile away from the Bundy's ranch. And then as you got off of the interstate, in the middle of nowhere, as I pointed out, there's this little fence and area, and there was an officially printed up sign by the BLM that says First Amendment area. And somebody put a handwritten sign next to that and said, the First Amendment is not an area. And it got the Republican governor, and everyone was very concerned about what was going on there. Everybody was talking about how the BLM wanted to shut down free speech. We see this constantly. I'm really not certain. I've got more concern, I think, about what's going to happen with the Democrat convention in Philadelphia based on what Ja'Kari Jackson and I saw when the Pope was here. We went to Washington and New York, and they were very cool with things. They were able to handle massive protests, and we saw that again in Washington when I went to cover Donald Trump speaking to AIPAC. But when we went to Philadelphia, it was unbelievable how they shut that city down, and that's where the Democrat convention is going to be, and there's going to be a lot of unrest there. I think people are not realizing just how angry the Democrat left is going to be in Philadelphia and how overreaching the Philadelphia Police Department and the mayor have been in the past.
Well, first of all, we would be naive to think that the Democratic city machines in places like Cleveland and Philadelphia are not in league with the Clinton campaign, because mm-hmm. of course they are. Secondarily, I was very disappointed to see this morning Bernie Sanders say that he will vote for Hillary. Now, Bernie is not my cup of tea, and I made some caustic remarks about him early in the campaign, which I take back. I must tell you, I think he's run a great campaign, given the fact that he wasn't even a Democrat 6 months ago. He's raised an enormous amount of money. He has run a great grassroots campaign. I like where he attacked Hillary on war and trade. I only wish that he had attacked her a bit more on corruption and her abuse of women. But it is disappointing to see Bernie join the club and ultimately turn out to support policies that he doesn't really support.
Yeah, let's play the clip that he had. He was on Morning Joe today, where he was declaring his fealty to Hillary Clinton. And I want to get your reaction to what he said and the reasons that he gave for why he would support Hillary Clinton. Here's that clip.
Are you going to vote for Hillary Clinton in November?
Yes. Yeah, I think the issue right here is I'm going to do everything I can to defeat Donald Trump. I think Trump, in so many ways, will be a disaster for this country if he were to be elected president. We do not need a president whose cornerstone of his campaign is bigotry, is insulting Mexicans and Latinos and Muslims and women, who does not believe in the reality of climate change, when virtually every scientist who has studied this issue understands we have a global crisis. This is not somebody who should become president. What my job right now is to fight for the strongest possible platform in the Democratic Convention. And as we speak in St. Louis, that's going on right now. Mm-hmm. And that means a platform that represents working people, that stands up to big money interests. And that's what we're trying
to
do.
So your vote will be a vote for Hillary Clinton or against?
Well, I don't want to parse words right now. What I am trying to do right now is to make sure that the Democratic Party becomes a party that represents working people, not Wall Street, that is prepared to have...
Okay, so she wasn't really understanding whether he was going to vote for Hillary or for Donald, because he said he's going to stand up to big money interest. I think that really confused her, because they gave a mixed signal there. Roger, what do you think? Because she is the candidate for big money interest, isn't she?
Yeah, I think it's Bernie who's confused.
Yeah.
On the important issues of trade and war, his views are much closer to Donald Trump's than they are to Hillary Clinton's. Secondarily, if Bernie Sanders really thinks Hillary Clinton is going to police or clean up Wall Street, good luck on that. he is sadly naive.
Yeah.
But you also see the continuing effort on the left to smear Donald Trump as a bigot, racist, hater, trigger happy, a lunatic. I've known Trump for 39 years, knew his parents well. I know his family well, and I have great affection for them. These are lies. Mm-hmm. Donald Trump doesn't have a racist bone in his body. In fact, unlike Bernie Sanders, unlike Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump has created thousands of jobs for black people, for brown people, for all Americans. So I see the 1964 Goldwater technique of the big lie. Oh, Barry Goldwater, he's nuts. You remember that, David?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he was going to pull the button. You had the countdown Daisy commercial, you know, where they only played it once, but then the media just kept playing it for free over and over and over again.
Yeah, it's the same technique. And the problem you have here is that the American people now aren't buying it. In other words,
right.
I think voter dissatisfaction and voter suspicion has now spread beyond the institutions of government and the Congress and the political system to now include big media. In other words, the voters know that CNN is in bed with the political establishment. They know that CNN is only going to publicize information beneficial to the Clintons. That's why we sometimes jokingly call it the Clinton News Network.
That's right. And of course, that narrative of talking about how Brexit was xenophobic and racist, they didn't buy that either. You know, I talked about how the Labor Party was divided, for the membership from the voters from the leadership, and how the Tories were divided. But the media in Britain was all together on that racist, xenophobe narrative. The people can get their information outside of mainstream media now. And the truth will out on this, and it did in the Brexit vote. We're talking to Roger Stone of StoneZone.com. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with another segment with Roger Stone, and then we're going to have Paul Joseph Watson joining us in the next hour. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Roger Stone, StoneZone.com. No stranger to those of you who listen to InfoWars.com. We've been fortunate enough to be able to talk to Roger Stone, a very experienced political analyst. We're going to talk to him more about what he thinks Brexit means and its implications for the American election. Before we get back to Roger, real quickly, we have a new special, Deep Cleanse, 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. And of course, this is the Rolls Royce of all-in-one cleansing. Instead of buying 5, 6, or even 7 different cleansing products, we put this all together in one after decades of scientific research. It's 20% off now at InfoWarsLife.com. This is our fastest selling formula yet, and it's going to sell out pretty quickly, especially at this price. Also, we have Hillary for Prison t-shirts. Get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt. limited edition, 50% off for 1 week. And we've been doing this now for several days, so I'm not sure how much longer that's going to run. When you buy one for 50% off, you get a link to, and you'll see there when you buy that first one, you'll see a link where you can sign up for our newsletter. If you do that, you can get additional ones for 75% off. That's an incredible price. And just as I was pointing out, this one guy says, this is a day that the British people defied their jailers. You know, Hillary wants to be your jailer. No, send her to prison instead, okay? This is there's either her or you. One of us is going to go to jail. And finally, we have the Alexa Pure water filters, 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com. That's everything from the highest quality, largest systems down to the shower filters that will take the chlorine out of your municipal water supply. All of those, 20% off, all the Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. Let's go back to Roger Stone now. Roger, it was a great statement from Donald Trump. He said the people of the United Kingdom have voted to reassert control over their own politics, borders, and economy. He said, come November, the American people will have the chance to redeclare their independence. Americans will have a chance to vote for trade, immigration, foreign policies that will put our citizens first. They'll have the chance to reject today's rule by the global elite. They can embrace real change that delivers a government by and for the people. He says, I hope America is watching. It will soon be time to believe in America again. And so we saw the voters in Britain vote to make Britain great again. Will the voters in America vote to make America great again? I think they will. And I think this really lines up perfectly with what Donald Trump has been saying in this campaign. And what he's been saying, as you pointed out, with NAFTA and other things, he's been talking about this going back to the early 80s.
Yeah, Donald Trump's been very consistent. He has never been a globalist. He's always been deeply suspicious of the, he was opposed to NAFTA. He was indeed opposed to the Iraq War. There's another British analogy that occurred to me this week, David, and that is, as you know, there were tumultuous changes in the Trump campaign. Donald Trump, I think, wisely fired Corey Lewandowski, who was, I think, more concerned about himself than the future of a Trump presidency. Interestingly, now Lewandowski's going to work at CNN, which I view to be the most negative, the most anti-Trump of the networks.
Wow, that's interesting.
Many reporters have asked me in the last 48 hours whether the Trump campaign can possibly gear up quickly enough in terms of all the key elements that they need, organization, research, analytics, and so on. And the answer is yes. Now, the Trump campaign will never be the well-oiled political machine that the Clintons have, which is a bureaucratic, top-heavy, you know, the assistants have assistants.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And we'll talk about that, too, because that was the narrative at the beginning of the week was, oh, you know, look at all the money she has. Well, look at all the money that Jeb Bush had. And we used to hear from these same people that it was a sign of corruption to have that much money. Now it's a sign of virtue. Stay with us. We're going to be talking to Roger Stone for another 5 minutes on the other side of the hour. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Roger Stone. We have him for one more segment. Now, Paul Joseph Watson is going to be joining us in the next segment. And then the bottom of the hour, we have Dr. Steve Pachinik, who's going to be joining us to talk about the global implications of Brexit. They declared their independence yesterday, folks. It's going to be a long, complicated, messy divorce, but it's very important that they declared their independence. So we've been talking to Roger Stone about the parallels between the anti-globalist movement in Britain, the fact that they tried to portray this as racism and xenophobia, the same way they're trying to attack Donald Trump. But people understand that globalism is destroying their country. And so I want to get back to Roger Stone, because just before we had to go to break, he pointed out that Corey Lewandowski, who was just fired from the Trump campaign, is now working for CNN. I think that's really amazing. And of course, everybody's been telling us all week, Roger, that it's really a problem for Donald Trump that he doesn't have the kind of money that Hillary Clinton does. But that's always been a virtue for them to say, we got to get the money out of politics. And now they're saying they want it in. Of course, part of this is self-serving, because they're the ones who are going to get those tens of millions or hundreds of millions of dollars in TV ads. So they want to try to push that narrative. But The reality is that he's found a whole new way of campaigning. So tell us how you think that's going to play out now with the new campaign management staff that he's got.
The analogy that I would use is this is it is fair to say that the Trump campaign will always be a guerrilla type campaign, a seat of your pants, last minute, real, genuine, interesting campaign.
That's good news.
And the Clinton campaign will always be a boring, pre-tested, pre-scripted, pre-programmed, bureaucracy.
She hasn't even had a press conference for 200 days plus, right?
The best analogy, David, the British Royal Army versus the American colonists.
Mm-hmm.
Trump is going to have agility and tactical flexibility. Not a single word comes out of Hillary's mouth that hasn't been polled, repolled, focus grouped, roundtabled, committed, considered, and then sent to her in written talking points.
Yeah.
Literally nothing the woman says came from her own brain. Whereas Trump, as you know, he's interesting. He's provocative. He's honest. He tells you what he really thinks, whether it's politically correct or not. And frankly, I think it is one of the keys to his appeal.
Absolutely. You want to know what he thinks. And sometimes he'll say something, then he'll have to walk back and clarify it a little bit. But I'm fine with that. I think people appreciate that transparency. We have no transparency from government now, but we are going to find out what Hillary Clinton really does say, because we've got these tell-all books that are coming out from the people who were putting their lives on the line to protect her. And when they say, good morning, ma'am, she just looks at the guy and says, F you, you know? I mean, is the Clinton that the people around her who were protecting her with their lives knew.
Well, and I read yesterday that the Clinton spin machine, the Clinton press operation, very actively discouraging the networks and the cable news networks from interviewing the Secret Service agent Gary Byrne about his book. That in itself is outrageous. This is Soviet-style censorship. Why are the opinions or presentations of Mr. Byrne any less credible or less important or less covered by the First Amendment than the blathering by Bill and Hillary Clinton? It just shows the arrogance of these people. By the way, I read Byrne's book. It is terrific, and it won't be suppressed.
That's right. That's right. All they're going to do is drive their media organizations further into oblivion, because you'll have people like Sean Hannity pick it up. We'll pick it up. We'll talk about it. We'll interview them. That's what the word is going to get out there. Roger Stone, thank you so much for joining us. StoneZone.com. That's great news about that victory in Cleveland. We're going to be right back with Paul Joseph Watson from the UK to break down his point of view on Brexit. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this June 24th, 2016. A day that will go down in history. There's a great editorial from Tim Stanley of the Telegraph, and he starts out saying, there were two referendums on Thursday. The first was on the membership in the EU. The second was on the British establishment. Leave won both, and the world will never be the same again. He says it's impossible to overstate how remarkable this victory is. 20 years ago, Euroscepticism was a backbench Tory rebellion and a political cult. It was a dispute located firmly on the right with little appeal to Labour voters. It took UKIP to drag it to the center of political life. It was given momentum by the issue of immigration. Slowly, it has emerged as a lightning rod for anti-establishment activism. And I would say not just anti-establishment, but anti-globalism. We all see how this is working out for us economically as well as culturally. He says, slowly, the establishment consensus came to resemble not just a conspiracy, but worse, a confederacy of dunces. I think that's absolutely true. Joining us now from the UK is our own Paul Joseph Watson. Paul, did you really think that they would let them win this vote? I mean, I am absolutely ecstatic and amazed that this actually won.
I was not very optimistic last night. I mean, we had the huge run-up with the propaganda, the Joe Cox death.
That's
they
right.
had a poll that came out. It was a quasi-exit poll right before the vote started, after the voting just finished around 10 o'clock, which found 52% in favor of Remain. Mm-hmm. So then everyone, all the virtue signalers, all the leftists got out on Facebook, bragged about it, you know, rolled in it, celebrated it, rubbed it in everyone's faces. And then what began to happen, as you mentioned, was that all these classically Labour areas, and Labour is obviously the, you know, the socialist collectivist party, but it was in these Labour areas where you have quite poor working class white people whose livelihoods have been completely eviscerated by things like mass immigration. They've been completely ignored by Westminster. They've been completely cut off from, you know, having a stake in the country. They were massively voting for Leave. So in places like Sunderland, they only expected 6% to vote in favour of Leave over Remain. It was 22%. And from that first moment, that was the first vote that came in, the Remain side started to panic because they thought, hang on here, something's going on. You know, then Newcastle came in, that wasn't as expected. So the first results were a complete shock, and then it got progressively more interesting as the night went on.
Because then it started seesawing back and forth. I looked at that and I thought, oh, you know what? You're watching these massive swings. I think somebody said we've had a six-month high in the pound followed by a six-month low and all in the same day. I was looking at this and saying, yeah, they're just playing everybody. They're going to roll this out a little bit so that they can roil the markets and make some money, because that's how these guys make money, is off of volatility. So I thought, yeah, here it comes. Now they're going to say Remain is there. And if they don't have a massive landslide here, they're going to come in and swamp it with the votes that they stuff in these areas that they control. But that didn't happen, and I was absolutely amazed.
No, and it didn't happen because those, you know, traditionally Labour voting working class white people all voted to Leave.
Yeah.
So you had this kind of sneering, snobbish middle class elite in London who were all voting to Remain. They were counting on London being a huge turnout to swing it the way of Remain. But it was interesting. The night before, we had the most amazing thunder and lightning and rain. There were floods everywhere. And then right before people finished work yesterday, the heavens opened again. So if you believe in God, then, you know, he's yeah. Vote Leave.
That's right. That's right. He pushed it. It was the people who were committed to this, who were informed voters, they were going to turn out come hell or high water, and they did. That's great. You know, and we're seeing, this is one of the interesting things, article that's up on Drudge Report. Alan Greenspan, you talk about all the experts who are saying, oh, this is, you know, we got to have this, trying to create fear with people, trying to tell them that this is about racism and xenophobia and everything. And now we got Alan Greenspan. Listen to the way that he reacted. He says, this is the worst period I recall since I've been in public service. There's nothing like it, including the crisis. Remember October 19th, 1987, when the Dow went down by a record amount, 23%? I thought that was the bottom of all potential problems. But this has a corrosive effect that won't go away. And he just keeps going on and on and on. He says, but at the heart of it is the euro currency. And he doesn't expect this to go away. He expects to see this problem continue, because that's another issue. It's not just the immigration. It's not just the regulation coming out of Brussels, but it was also the economic disasters that were created by the euro currency and the way they mismanaged that, which also created a flood of immigrants coming from some of the European countries into Britain. So that was a double whammy in terms of immigration, having to be able to absorb the workers. It's great to see all the pollsters wrong and all these pundits and economists and elitists and globalists. They've been proven wrong, and the people have rejected them, haven't they, Paul?
They've rejected them. This is the dawn of a new populist revolt. This is truly an uprising. But what I want to warn against, and this is what I've talked about in a video that's going to go up on Infowars.com in about 20 minutes' time, is the battle has just begun.
Yeah.
We haven't won the war. This is the start of the process. So what you're going to see, and you're already seeing it today, is the economic uncertainty, the financial woes will be blamed on Brexit. Understand, everything bad that happens going forward will be blamed on Brexit, even to the point where there's a Daily Mirror article that was obviously a heavily in favor of Vote Remain, saying that the next attack, the next ISIS attack in Europe, will be Brexit's fault, basically, because Brexit has paralyzed Europe. Again, nothing to do with Islam. Let's not talk about that.
Yeah.
The next terror attack will be blamed on Brexit. That's what they're saying. The next economic downturn will be blamed on Brexit, even though, as we pointed out, for years, this bubble has been about to burst. It's been inevitable for years. But when it finally pops, they're going to blame it on Brexit. So then they're going to go back and say, well, this has caused chaos. What we need is either a new deal with the EU to stay in it, but kind of get some token sovereignty back, or they'll just have a second referendum. Remember, this is what the EU has done over and over again. They're completely anti-democratic. France, Ireland, the Netherlands, other countries all voted to reject EU mandates. They made them vote again until they got the result they want. These people are complete snakes. They're going to pull any kind of dirty trick imaginable to, you know, try and snatch victory from the jaws of defeat. That's what's coming. That's what we need to guard against.
Oh, absolutely. It's a process, as one of the headlines said, this is going to be a complex and long-lasting divorce if this thing works out. They're not even talking about changing Cameron until October. But it's a process that could take a couple of years to wind its way through. They don't really know how this is going to work. And as you point out, rightfully so, Paul, they're going to blame everything on Brexit. Already today, they're telling everybody that, making the case that the UK shot itself in the FTSE. You know, the stock index, the FTSE is pronounced FTSE for those of you not watching it in London. But they're saying that all of this volatility that we see there, where is that coming from? Of course, that's coming from the traders and the central bankers who are the globalists who were trying to keep Britain in the EU. And of course, they're going to be manipulating the market. That's what they do. And this truly is just the beginning of a war. As I said before, we had the Declaration of Independence, July 4, 1776. The war had not even really, well, there had been some shooting prior to that. April 19th, they went to take the guns in Lexington. So that was about 3 months later. But bottom line is the war really had not started at that point. That was the very beginning. So this is Britain's Declaration of Independence. The war is going to be an information war. It's going to be a financial war. They're going to tell everybody, look, you're getting poor, and as you just said, Paul, everything is going to be blamed on Brexit.
Yeah, and they've got an army of left-wing collectivist morons to back them up. This is the problem. Already today, we have a new petition that's going to be debated in Parliament because it's passed the threshold. 154,000 signatures already. EU referendum rules triggering a second EU referendum. This is what they're going to keep pushing.
Wow.
They're going to say, because it was a close vote, you know, 48% to 52%, we need to do this properly because it's so important. So we need to just make sure that this is the case. Even though the turnout here is so high, you know, Vote Leave won by, I think it was over a million votes in the end. But this is what they're going to push because these people are anti-democratic. They're authoritarians. Just by the frothing reaction on social media alone today, and I've posted it up on my Twitter page, some of it, you can see that these people, some of them aren't going to back off. They're going to push for a second referendum until they get the result they want because they don't believe in democracy. They don't believe in the democratic will of the British people. So they're going to be supported by the political establishment in the move for that second referendum. They're going to try and pull this, so it's up to us to stop that from happening.
Wow. Wow. Now, I got to say, before we go any further, I love your new background there. Instead of the map that's usually behind you, I like the Union Jack. What's going to happen in Scotland, you think? Are they going to get another referendum for leaving the UK?
Well, of course, Scotland, the vast majority of them voted to remain because they're completely dependent on England, mainly. So, yes, they're going to have, it looks like, another independence referendum. So they can basically stay in the EU and because they're dependent on this corrupt, failing institution. So good luck to them. I mean, the Scottish independence thing was a little bit different from this. It had different agendas, different motives behind it. But it does look like it's going to trigger another vote in Scotland for their independence.
Let me ask you about the fisheries issue, because as you've pointed out and as others have pointed out, I guess we'll get to it when we come back. There's not been any control by Britain on the North Atlantic Fishing Commission. They don't really have direct representation like some of the other countries do. I mean, are the fishermen now going to be allowed to fish? Or is that going to have to wait for months or years? Because that's the whole issue. If they can string this thing out, show only the disadvantages, but not let people enjoy any of the new freedoms that they would get being out of the EU. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're here with Paul Joseph Watson from the UK. We're talking about Brexit. It's Brexit, baby. They're single again, and this is going to be a long divorce. It is going to be an opportunity during this divorce for the rejected spouse, the EU, to try to make things as miserable as possible for the UK. And that's what we've been talking about with Paul Joseph Watson. Before we go back to Paul, I just want to remind you that the way you keep InfoWars free and independent, and it is a very valuable ally, I hope you understand, in this information war, the way you keep us free and independent is by your support, and we really appreciate that. And so we offer these specials from time to time. Our best-selling supplement here, the Rolls-Royce, the all-in-one cleansing product, Deep Cleanse, is now 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Again, this is our fastest-selling InfoWars Life formula. We keep selling out of it for weeks and months at a time, but we not only have it back in stock now, but we have it at 20% off. Also, your Hillary for Prison t-shirts. Get one at 50% off. When you go to that link, you will find another link to sign up to our newsletter. And if you do that, you'll get a code for additional shirts at 75% off. Those Hillary for Prison t-shirts, those are real conversation starters. Let's just call it that, conversation starters. And also, Alexa Pure water filters, 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com. And that's from our very smallest shower filter all the way up to the super high-quality gravity-fed Alexa Pure Pro water filtration system. Gets out 99.9999% of bacteria, disinfectants, volatile organic contaminants, and hormones. You'll find that at InfoWarsStore.com. All Alexa Pure water filters at 20% off. You know, they always projected this as a project of fear. That's what people were calling David Cameron's portrayal of the doom and gloom that was going to happen. And as Paul was just saying, everything that happens now for the next couple of years until they can dissolve these political bonds and they're going to try to pull them back in, everything is going to be blamed on Brexit. Everything that goes wrong financially and otherwise is going to be blamed on them. And when I saw this, it made me think, I want to play this little 15-second clip here from V for Vendetta. Nailed it years ago. Here's that clip.
Fear became the ultimate tool of this government.
I want everyone to remember why they need us.
I wish I wasn't afraid all the time.
People should not be afraid of their government. The government should be afraid of their people.
That's right. Fear became the ultimate tool, Paul. But a real government fears its people, not the other way around. What do you see happening at this point with the fisheries, for example? Or any of these other things that could be rolled back as Britain gets its independence? I mean, that's going to take a while for the fishermen to be allowed to fish again?
Well, David Cameron, who has resigned today, I mean, it's a complete bloodbath. You know, Corbyn's probably going to have to resign as well.
Mm-hmm.
Next week, he's going to have to trigger Article 50, which, you know, this has never happened before that a country has left the EU. So the process is it takes 2 years afterwards to completely untangle from most of the regulations. Some of the regulations and the laws relating to free movement of people and trade barriers could take 5 years. But what's important is to keep this Brexit government, this new Brexit government that we're going to have, honest. Because they could just, you know, re-implement all of the EU's regulations anyway. They could just copy them wholesale if they get infiltrated by globalist sympathies, which is always a massive risk.
Yes.
So we need to keep those people honest. The other angle on this is, you know, this is, again, it's about reclaiming this flag. It's like in America, you've been lectured for decades and decades about how you're this evil empire. You know, we've had it for even longer, you know, where mm-hmm. our glory days are gone. We're an old rusted colonial empire. We're useless. We're nothing anymore. And this is about, you know, reclaiming some actual sense of patriotism in being British. This is the first time that many people have experienced this in their entire lives. I mean, patriotism is just completely unknown in Britain before this. So this, again, it's a stunning rejection of the status quo. It's the dawn of a new populist uprising, but it's only the beginning of the battle, because going forward, we need to keep this post-Brexit government honest and make them, force them to follow through on what they actually promised. That's what it's all about now.
And of course, you're going to have some help, because there's all these other European countries that want to get out of it as well. So the European Union is going to start unraveling because of those kind of pressures. But they're also nothing but a confederacy of dunces. They can't control their or won't control their borders. We know that's a deliberate thing. But they can't control their economies either. And so you're going to have some allies in there just from their mismanagement. Paul Joseph Watson, thank you for joining us from the UK. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to talk to Steve Pachinik, and he's going to tell us why this is great news and why there is nothing to fear. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Steve Pachinik. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this day that Britain has declared its independence through Brexit. Joining us now to talk about the implications is Dr. Steve Pachinik, no stranger to InfoWars listeners, but let me remind you of his qualifications: an MD, a PhD in American psychiatry, former State Department official, author, publisher, critically acclaimed author, along with Tom Clancy of the paperback series. Dr. Steve Pachinik, and you'll find him at stevepachinik.com. Welcome, Dr. Pachinik.
Thank you for bringing me on the show, Paul. I really wanted to come on the show just to give a little perspective from my point of view and to say to our audience, a wonderful audience, and to you and Alex, that this was coming about for quite a long time. First of all, I've been writing about this for about 20 years. In one of the Op Center series, I wrote about the devolution of the EU and the necessity for the EU to devolve into entities, not necessarily nation states. Then in my book one and book two of Steve Talks, I insisted that Brexit be the beginning of the end of the EU. Now, let me explain, if I don't think anybody else has explained. The EU was created at the time when I was in France in 88 on a mission, was created between France and Germany as an attempt to stop Germany from coming into power again or allowing it to become a martial force. This was a total ethereal concept concocted by a few French socialists and sociology, none of which had any bearing on reality. What France was afraid of, and it has always been afraid of, is that France has lost war since the time of Napoleon Bonaparte, who, by the way, was Corsican. But because of World War I and World War II, France decided that it needed to co-opt Germany into a concept called the European market. The whole aspect of it was fallacious. It had one currency, it had no military, no intelligence, no force behind it. It had France not as the central power, but Germany became the central power, and the Frankfurt Bank of Germany was actually the most powerful element in all of the EU. So for the past 10 to 15 years, as much as France would like to think that they co-opted Germany, Germany in fact became the dominant power, paradoxically. As a result, they lent out a lot of money and credits to Spain, Italy, and Portugal, who in turn defaulted on all their loans. So what does this mean for the Alex Jones Show and for us in general? For America, quite frankly, at the bottom line, it's extremely good what happened in the EU. The reason for that is that flight capital and certain immigrants will start to come to the United States, because in this world of uncertainty and disorder, the one country that maintains its political, economic, and military stability is the Republic of the United States. What, in fact, will happen to the rest of Europe is that nationalism will arise, and eventually we will see Catalonia or Barcelona break away from Spain, which is already a corrupt country, was not really a country itself. It was created by a French king who, in fact, coagulated the Basque in Valencia and Madrid and the Catalan provinces. That will break up. Part of France will overthrow probably Hollande, the president, who's a socialist, because they have a major unemployment problem, and they're now in riot mode. The immigration problem that came in from Syria as a result of Putin's punishment to the West for our taking down the Soviet Union has now made it more imperative for the European countries to make sure that they don't have what's called the Schengen Agreement. In other words, they will refuse to accept immigrants and they will refuse to accept other Europeans to come through their own country. From our point of view, unfortunately, as a republic, we did not anticipate this on the formal level, although some of us who wrote and were part of the Alex Jones and the Alex Jones Nation and the InfoWar Nation, we could see it coming very quickly and actually insisted on it because it had a strong bearing on what we do here in America. And what do I mean? For many reasons, and we've talked about this for over 14 years, the stand down and the false flags that were created by Bush, Cheney, and eventually the Clintons were involved, and now Obama, was really part of not only taking away our guns, but more importantly, reinstituting the federal government as a major source of power over the states and the governors. I had warned the federal government repeatedly at expense to myself and others, as has Alex and as has many people at the InfoWar Nation, that the federal government can no longer sustain its legitimacy if it continues to produce these false flags like Orlando, Sandy Hook, and the various other elements we were talking about. The president of the United States is not qualified to be the president. The problem is now we don't have an individual other than Trump to be able to take over the entity we call the Republic and make it viable economically. Now, why am I optimistic? Our stock markets will go down in relative terms to the European markets, but what in fact will happen is the dollar will increase in value, gold will go up to a certain point, the euro will drop, the pound will drop, the yen will drop, all because these are stagnant economies. In the meantime, because we're based on an entrepreneurial nation, we will have a very strong dollar and a very strong capacity to now reconstitute our manufacturing base using 3D printing and all the other elements that we've developed in technology, and therefore our markets don't now will be overseas, but more importantly internally. I see this as a very major revolution across the board for both America and the world. It's the end of what we would call the internationalists, the ones who wanted a unified one world nation, the Council on Foreign Relations. All that nonsense is gone. It was gone in one day.
Well, yeah.
But the preparation for the Brexit was really about 10 to 20 years in coming. And I think in part, I know Alex would say I'm wrong, I think in part shows like Alex Jones and the other shows that were the alternative media were very important in promoting nationalism and promoting and saying, listen, we can no longer exist in an ethereal concept called the EU or even the United States of America with presidents who are not qualified, with presidents who begin to attack our own people, kill our own people, and therefore we have to decide what we want to do at this particular point. I just wanted to add those elements in at a time when I think it's extremely propitious for us to understand we are going to do better, and now we have the ability to say to our federal government, enough is enough. And now I understand Texas is even going into a nationalist movement.
We've said we ought to call it, we ought to have a Texit. As a matter of fact, it was about a month ago, Dr. Pachinik, that I did a video where I took Boris Johnson's 8 points. He said, here's 8 reasons why Britain would be better off outside of the EU. And so I looked at these things, like the net amount of money that was being sent from Britain into the EU. And I said, what's the net amount of money that Texas is sending to Washington and so forth, each one of these things. And actually, we can make a much better case for us leaving Washington if they don't stand down. There was an article today on the Drudge Report saying that there are more armed bureaucrats than there are Marines in our country. That's the danger that we have. That's the true standing army of potential oppressors that we have there. And that's a very dangerous thing, I believe.
No, I agree with you. Actually, I had one time I had an armed IRS agent come to my house in the area I lived in, and I told him, you get out or you get shot, because that's not going to happen. And that was a while ago. But you hit it right on the head. The question is, do we really need the federal government at this point in time?
Mm-hmm.
Given the quality of people who've populated that particular area, the White House, and having worked for 5 presidents, at this point in time, I can say categorically, we don't really need the president of the United States. It's a disposable. I wrote a blog saying it's a disposable entity. Barack Obama was the ultimate or penultimate of someone who was totally unqualified, someone who came in through what we call the dark side or the CIA and the intelligence bureau, along with the what we call the CIA of the Catholics in Action, who brought him up through the system, and the Democrats wanted him. The reason the Democrats wanted him was that they can impose federalism in the legislation that they needed in order to obviate the strength of the governor. And I remember having a discussion with an extreme liberal congressman saying eventually the governors and the local commissioners will have far more power than Congress or the president. And he was furious. So there's no question in my mind now that these false flags that will continue and are the result of an incompetent FBI, an incompetent CIA, an incompetent Secret Service. I mean, we are wasting so much money for nothing. Every time Obama does something, it costs us millions and millions of dollars and accomplishes nothing. So now we have an opportunity to begin to build up a referendum peacefully. I have to say that peacefully because, in fact, once the will of the people is known in each state, then, in fact, we can demand our own secession because the United States of America was brought together by an artificial war, by a man who really was not a very honorable man. And I'm one of the few who did not like Abraham Lincoln, who found him to be manic, depressive, to be Marfan, and created what we call the auto genocide.
I agree. Oh, absolutely, I agree. I mean, look at his record in terms of setting up martial law, in terms of jailing politicians, in terms of disbanding legislatures. I mean, it was absolutely, he gave us our first income tax. And on and on and on, suspended habeas corpus for people. It was a total dictatorship. And of course, there were factors, that, as I've pointed out before, there were factors happening in Europe. The competition between agrarian and industrial interests, as well as the consolidation into a nation state. I mean, in Italy, they had a war in 1860 with Garibaldi's army. But I see the same narrative being put out by Biden, even though we've had Hillary Clinton, who's been busted. It was only about a month ago that she was saying Britain needs to stay in the European Union. We had Obama go over there and threaten them, telling them that they're going to get at the back of the line on trade deals if they get out. And so now we see Biden still trying the same old, tired, divisive, divide and conquer. He said he's in Ireland right now, and he says this is going to provide fertile terrain for reactionary politicians and demagogues who are peddling xenophobia, nationalism, isolation, et cetera, okay? That's the way they do this. Nobody was buying that. Nobody's buying that here in America. And Dr. Pachinik, I think the true multiculturalism is what they've been trying to shut down so much in Europe, trying to shut down all of these native cultures, this rich tapestry of culture that was European culture. They're trying to subsume that, dumb it down, homogenize it, and overrun it with immigration from the third world. I think that's the true multiculturalism that they despise, I think, is really something that ought to be lifted up.
Well, I agree with you, Paul. Not only is it demagoguery coming out of Biden and Hillary, it's both arrogance and ignorance at the same time. That's why they can no longer really represent the voice of the American people. Mm-hmm. But let's be even more clear about it. We have had an army that did not have a country. We have sent our boys to war over 30 years into areas which have no national security interest whatsoever to us. Yes. Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria. And I was in Syria. I was interrogated there. It was clear to me Bashar Assad could control 80% of the country. He did. We had no need to get involved. And in fact, we have generals who really failed in their performance. But more importantly, we have to hold Congress accountable for all of this and really dissolve Congress. I've seen for the most part, most of these individuals are totally useless. What they've done is to incur a lot of cost on our part. And basically, we've paid more and more money to keep our generals on pension funds than to have active military capability. In fact, now our military is really very poor. And when you see them dispersed all over the world, what you have is Pax Americana. We now have an empire. The republic is dissolving, and that's why we have to reconstitute ourselves to say, no, the republic cannot dissolve. We, the people, will stand by what we want, but we do not want expansions into areas that we have no interest whatsoever. And instead, we want to get into effective trade negotiations, as Trump has been talking about, and build up our own infrastructure. The truth of the matter is that, for the most part, Europe was finished right after World War II. When FDR was quite brilliant, what he did was to pit the Nazis against the Soviet Union so that we could arise, we, the United States, a capitalist country, could become a formidable superpower. And we did. Our legacy then went downhill. After the Vietnam War, it continued to go downhill. We went into wars that we had no need to go into. Our brave soldiers were restricted from doing what they needed to do because of incompetent generals, incompetent leaders, and incompetent POTUSes. You know, we glorify JFK, but at the same time, we don't talk about the fact he had Addison's disease. He was totally incompetent. He had to be on drugs. He had to be on steroids. He should never have been president. Same thing with LBJ, who did false flags on the Liberty, who did the Gulf of Tonkin, a totally false flag there. And the same thing with Nixon, Reagan, Bush. I mean, each one had their own major problems. It wasn't a question Republican or Democrat. It was a question that we no longer needed a president of the United States of America. That was a fallacious concept. It's outdated now. With the internet and cyber nation, we no longer need that.
Oh, absolutely. And if we look at talking about Texas becoming independent, if we look at the population of Texas, it's 10 times bigger than the original 13 colonies combined when they got their independence. And we have energy self-sufficiency and other issues. We'd be one of the largest economies in the world if we were on our own. I want to ask you about where you think this is going to, what's going to happen in the next couple of years, because this is going to be a very long and protracted process. We've got a lot of different countries where there is a rising movement. And I think it's important to point out this is not all on the right. It was ignored pretty much by our press earlier in the week because I think they didn't want to give any momentum to Brexit. But the fact that they had the first woman mayor in Rome, some people talked about the fact, hey, they got the first woman mayor. But the real issue was that she was a populist, that she was an anti-globalist, and she wasn't even a person on the right. This party is very much a left-wing environmentalist party, but they are anti-populist. And so I look at that and I say, I think that's a strong indication that Donald Trump can win some of the people who are thinking on the who are Bernie Sanders supporters. And this is not just right wing extremism and xenophobia, as they point out. It's people understanding that they're getting a very bad deal from this. How do you think this is going to play out? I mean, certainly, Paul was right. They're going to use everything that goes wrong to demonize this. They're going to try to bring back a second referendum. We'll talk about that when we come back, Dr. Pechenik. I want to get your thoughts on that.
Sure.
We're talking about, you mentioned Catalonia, Basque, probably getting independence. Now Scotland is saying, hey, we want to try that one more time as well. So this is not done. They're still fighting, and there is a wounded beast right now on the loose, and that is the globalist. We're going to be right back with Dr. Steve Pechenik. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Dr. Steve Pechenik. We're talking about the consequences of Brexit. What is going to happen next? We've talked about how there's a moving independence movement. People want control of their government. They want government to be closer to them. And yet what we see happening is both in Brussels and in Washington, we see a government that is increasingly distant from the people, increasingly arrogant. And even though they are less and less attuned to what we want them to do, they are talking very loudly to us, managing the smallest details of our lives. Before I go back to Dr. Pechenik, I want to point out that we have a new special. We have Deep Cleanse, 20% off. And, of course, that is the Rolls-Royce of cleansers that we have here. It is an all-in-one cleanser, our fastest-selling product. It's a new special we have at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, we have the 20% off the Alexa Pure water filters. Every one of the filters, from the largest to the smallest, are 20% off. And then there's the huge sale that we have at InfoWarsStore.com on the Hillary for Prison t-shirts. You can get the first one for 50% off. There'll also be a link where you can sign up for our free newsletter. If you do that, you can get additional shirts at 75% off. So that's a huge savings, 75% off unlimited Hillary for t-shirt, Hillary for Prison t-shirts, if you sign up for our free newsletter. And of course, that has unique content. That's a good thing anyway. I mean, it's got specials in it all the time for those people that are unique, short specials, as well as unique content that you won't see on our website. That's a free newsletter that you can sign up for there. I want to go back to Dr. Pechenik. How do you see this breaking out in terms of some of these other countries that may be suing for their independence, Dr. Pechenik?
Well, it's very interesting, David. I think you pointed out quite a few. The first one, ironically, that will probably split is Belgium itself, which has never really been an integrated country. It's been divided between the Walloons and the Flemish. In other words, the French-speaking and the Flemish. They don't really get along. They've had a very hard time getting a prime minister or president. And ironically, Brussels became the very center of an ethereal concept called the EU. So from the very beginning, when I saw the concept of EU being stationed in Brussels, I said, this is doomed to failure. So I think Belgium is going to break up. Uh-huh. I think Luxembourg, anything that has to do with financial systems that depend on England will do very poorly. Now, let me explain why. One of the reasons why Obama came over to the EU, as usual, it was at the beck and call of our bankers on Wall Street, not our regional bankers. This is about Wall Street bankers, because I think our regional and local banks are exceedingly in good shape because they have huge reserves of dollars. What's happening to Wall Street is because they're so lazy and so greedy, they didn't want to build the infrastructure required to go through all these countries, the Netherlands, Germany, Poland, Luxembourg, and France, and instead relied on England. England had a 24/7 position of financial capability, which could trade all the way from Asia to the Middle East. That's going to go away. So the American banking system, the large elements, have to be involved, have to really redirect and put money into the infrastructure of banking all over. So I think Belgium will break apart. Spain will break apart. Because from the very beginning, when I first wrote the books in Op Center 20 years ago, I used Catalan and the Basque region and Barcelona in particular to say they are not Spanish and they do not belong with Madrid. From there, I would say Luxembourg will be dissolved. I have a dog yelling.
I hear him in the background. Can you stay with us another segment, or do you have to go?
Yeah. No.
All right. We're going to come back right after the top of the hour. We'll be back with Dr. Steve Pechenik. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Dr. Steve Pechenik. He was gracious enough to remain on for this one more segment. The next segment, we're going to have Alex Jones with another report talking about what is happening today. Of course, this is a huge seismic change. Dr. Pechenik has been talking about this, and I've got an article here in front of me from his website, stevepechenik.com, going back to this last Monday, talking about how urging people to vote for Brexit, breaking down the origins, as he sees it, of the European Union and the issues before us. And it's been a very interesting conversation with Dr. Pechenik. You were just talking about the different countries, Dr. Pechenik, that you think will break up. A lot of people have said they believe, in terms of those that might be leaving the European Union, one of the first candidates would be Sweden, because they've been essentially politically in agreement with Britain. They see Britain as a counterweight and the only counterweight to a dominant Germany. So with Britain gone, Sweden had said that they'd be likely to go. And I think it would be easier for them to get out because they did not adopt the euro, just as Britain did not. A lot of these countries that would like to leave now are going to have a much more difficult time of it because they've foolishly abandoned their own currencies.
Well, it's interesting, David. I think you're right on. I'm looking at Sweden. Sweden will leave because, first, it has a problem with the immigrants coming in.
Yes.
Secondly, the point that you made, which is an excellent point, was the fact that this is not a right-wing switch to Sweden. It will be a left-wing switch because it's a socialist government. It basically has to come to terms with the fact that it can no longer depend on the European Union and has to really in some way create its own viable economy.
Mm-hmm.
The one place in the Scandinavian countries that really has to decide what they want to do is Norway. Norway has been very efficient and effective in producing oil and garnering a lot of oil and a lot of kroners. And basically, they have been investing not in Europe, but they are one of the major investors in the United States. They're exceedingly quiet. They don't say anything about their investments. And like the Dutch, who are also very quiet investors, we're going to have a problem in the Netherlands because the Netherlands can no longer take care of all the immigrants that have come in. And I assume that in Texas, you've seen a lot of Dutch farmers come in because they can no longer use – the Netherlands or Holland as a basic, as a basis for farming, and instead they've come into Montana, Texas, and other areas where they can buy up huge milk farms, and they've become very efficient. So the Netherlands will have to break out and decide what they want to do. But we have to remember, the Netherlands has been they have been very effective, the Dutch, for over 350 years in trading overseas. So they have a history unlike anyone else. Poland will have a problem. Poland can no longer really remain inside the EU without the cover of England, and Poland is exceedingly afraid of Germany. And of course, as we know, the history of World War II starts with Germany invading Poland. Germany's currency will ironically probably convert to the Deutschmark. If I were Germany, I'd automatically convert to the Deutschmark, because the euro has no value in and of itself. It really depends on the strength of the Frankfurt Bank. Austria will probably also break out because it's aligned with Germany, and Hungary will probably break out as well because they're extremely Eurosceptic, and Hungary has already shifted to the right with a attitude saying that we don't want any more immigrants. As you pointed out, Italy, it's really an artificial construct. It's a very young country. It's less than probably 150 years old, but Garibaldi really was not all that effective. When I worked on the Aldo Moro kidnapping, it was very clear to me that Italy is a constellation of different segments of Italy. And in fact,
Northern Italy,
right on the head. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Northern Italy as well. They're looking.
You hit it right on the head, David.
Yeah.
They're going to split up. Northern and Southern Italy will split up.
Well, it is a fascinating time to be here. Very exciting time to see people stand up and reclaim their right to self-government. Thank you so much, Dr. Steve Pachinik. You can find more information from him at stevepachinik.com. We'll be right back with Alex Jones. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. This is truly a momentous day. So much so that Alex Jones has an analysis of what is going on with Brexit, what it means in the big picture, the big struggle between globalism and nationalism, the struggle against world government. Here's Alex Jones.
Alex Jones here with just one more note today on how big the British exit is to every man, woman, and child listening. No matter your race, your religion, it doesn't matter. Everybody should understand that human liberty is under attack by the world government project. And this thing has been devastatingly dealt a death wound. They threw everything they had at this. And they failed. We've turned the tide. They're failing on every front. But understand, they're going to launch counteroffensives that are going to be mind-blowing. And we've got to be ready for them. But this is such a big deal. They're going to try to block the EU program being basically dismantled in the UK. They're going to try to keep them in all these contracts. They're going to fight tooth and nail. They're going to manipulate stock markets. They're going to absolutely pull out the stops with Europe opening its borders even further to all the invaders. But in the final equation, it's an unelected secret corporate world government, and it's fundamentally unfair and fundamentally evil. And their whole hoax to try to block us and keep patriots from exposing their program has failed, and our credibility is only rising. Their credibility is only falling. And you ask, why does the mainstream media dig its hole even faster? It's because they can't help it. It's their arrogant nature. It's like I talked about earlier when the Financial Times of London came out and said, yeah, okay, we're building an authoritarian world government. We know best. Get used to it. But then would separately come out and write articles saying we're crazy. It doesn't exist. That mind game doesn't work anymore. And remember what Mark Twain said. It's my favorite quote. In the beginning, a patriot is a scarce man, hated, feared, and scorned. But in time, when his cause succeeds, the timid join him, because then it costs nothing to be a patriot. This is such a momentous time. And to see humanity waking up and fighting back is so beautiful. I tend to make fun of people and get angry at folks that are brain-dead zombies and totally buy into the whole media hype system. But remember, they have been brought into this by birth. They didn't have parents like you or I did that were informed or somewhat informed. A lot of people never really had a chance. And it's time for us to give them that intellectual chance, not from some fake liberal perspective of arrogance, but from the need to have our fellow humans be awakened and formed so that we can live in a free society. It's not charity we're talking about, it's survival. We've got to be engaged in this war because I'm telling you, our enemies have turned themselves over to pure evil. There's a saying from one of William Shakespeare's plays. I guess it's the Cleopatra and Mark Antony. And there's a line when she says, I'll never be a slave to love. I'll never be dominated and controlled by love. I'm never going to let love control me. Never going to let love be the number one thing in my life. And Mark Antony says to her, then you'll never have love. We ask ourselves, why are these people so bad? Because they've turned themselves over to wickedness. They're so blind and so into it, it's their nature, that they can't help it. They don't know. They look at us and think we're fools. But historically, and the psychology shows this, and the criminology shows it, psychopaths, sociopaths, and other people that follow this whole system of me, and lies and fraud and arrogance always bite off more than they can chew. They always think they're invincible. They're always too optimistic, and they always fall. The problem is now if they fall and try to stay in power like other elites have done, they'll use nuclear weapons to destroy the entire planet. So that's why folks in the military and people in the elite who understand this is true, but basically were brought up in it and don't know how to get out of it, we've got to have a real public discourse, and you've got to have a discourse in your councils of government and councils of governance to understand that this isn't a game, folks. And yes, we, the Patriot Liberty Movement of the United States, are Americana. We are the birthright of the Renaissance and the Magna Carta and all that came with it. And that we are here resisting this program. And that we've been right all along, and we've been your arch enemy all along. And you've told the public that we're violent and evil and horrible because you know we bring the light into the dark. You know we're fans of humanity. You know we're honorable. You know we're committed. And you know we're never going to stop. So I tell our enemies now, turn back, stop. Pull back your programs. You're so evil that you want to destroy prosperity so you can control us. That is so fundamentally bad to try to destroy progress, and you will not destroy progress. I love how you call yourselves on your avant-garde cutting edge progressives when you are regressive in everything you do. Breaking down society, dismantling, selling us austerity as a good idea while you live like kings. Your fraud's going down. Your fraud's coming down, and people resisting the leadership, the Nigel Farages, the Ron Pauls, the info warriors, are only one of the current waves against the globalists. I'd say the third or fourth wave since the 40s and the resistance against tyranny. But the next wave, as I've been telling you for a decade, is going to be gigantic. And the one after that, even bigger. Nothing can stop it. It's going to the stars. It's the true singularity of freedom. And that fourth wave is now coming in. Get ready, ladies and gentlemen. Get ready for epic times. I don't want to hear from anybody that we're living in boring times. We're living in incredible times. The enemy wants you to be tuned into false media, tuned into false paradigms, and just be bored and unhappy and not know what's going on and talking about sitcoms and drama and sports. They want you to sleep while they live. Well, I'm here to say it's time for the world to awaken, and it's time to make America and the world free again. And then we will be great again. Back to the live transmission emanating from Austin, Texas, worldwide. And I'm so proud that one of the main outposts of human liberty against tyranny is Texas. And I'm so proud of my fellow Texans and Americans and everyone else across the world and what the great folks in the UK have done. I salute you because we have won the war. The enemy doesn't know it yet, and it's going to be tough. It's going to be rough. Hitler didn't give up at the Battle of the Bulge. He didn't give up at Leningrad. He didn't give up. But finally, he gave up in that bunker, didn't he? Well, we're not giving up. And it's funny that the EU was a project of the Nazis. I'm not saying it's a Nazi conspiracy, but it is a Nazi project. That's a fact. That's admitted. That it kind of came back, and we're fighting it again. And we're going to go on fighting it, and we're never going to surrender any form of authoritarianism. I will tell you, after the EU globalist project is defeated, and that's a long way off still, The next big one is going to be the communist Chinese, and they are probably even more evil. That's why they're wedded to the globalists, but only in treaty, not in spirit. Infowars.com is where the resistance starts. It ends with you taking action. I want to salute all of you.
Absolutely right, and that's Alex Jones, and I certainly do appreciate what he has done for the last 2 decades plus, standing up for individual liberty, and now we're starting to see the fruit of that as we see people waking up to what is being done to them. This is the important thing here. Now, the BBC had an interesting article. You know, we covered this about a month ago. We talked about Brexit and Texit. You know, we had Texit, you know, get out, secede from America. I looked at the 8 reasons that Boris Johnson gave us and said, hey, we have those same reasons, but in spades. And if you look at it, comparing it to Texas. Now, the BBC has come out with their own 8 reasons as to why it worked. And I think it's interesting to take a look at their reasons. They say, number one, the Brexit economic warnings backfired. They said the public was bombarded with warnings about how they would be poor if they voted. But in the end, they weren't convinced by Project Fear. Or they believe that it was a price worth paying. And, of course, Project Fear is not what the BBC says, because the BBC is selling that narrative. There was an interesting short clip that we didn't play. Had it on in the list a couple of days ago from Michael Caine. And he was saying, hey, you know, there's going to be some problems, some things that we'll have to work out, but we will work them out. It's about self-government. And they understand that there has been a price that people have paid to be in the European Union. And they realized that that price, in terms of freedom, in terms of self-government, in terms of economics, was just simply not worth it. They go on. Number two, they say, well, that claim about £350 million a week net going to the EU, and then that would be available for things like the National Health Service. They say that claim got traction. They say, well, yeah, it's not true. And, you know, to that I would say you can argue over the numbers, over the quantity of it, but there is no doubt that there has been a net outflow. And is there any doubt that that outflow is going to continue to grow and grow and grow? So you can quibble about whether it's 350 million or if it's at 300 or is it 160, whatever it is. The bottom line is you keep your money to spend on your priorities and instead of having to send it to other countries who spend it on things that you don't want it spent on. Number three, they say Nigel Farage made immigration the defining issue. I would say no, the European Union made it the defining issue by the way they what they did with it. Number four, they said the public stopped listening to the prime minister. Well, they also stopped listening to the BBC as well, didn't they? And mainstream media. And that's what we're seeing here in America. They've lost their credibility. They cried wolf, but people understood that it wasn't, that there would be a price to pay. There is going to be a period of adjustment. They understand that the bankers, that gave us the LIBOR scandal, as well as HSBC and other large banks who've been caught money laundering for drug cartels, for terrorists, and were able to escape any punishment in both of those massive scandals. I understand these people are perfectly capable of rigging every market. They can rig the currency markets. They can rig the commodity markets. They can rig the stock markets. But the vast majority of people are going to be doing real things in their country, and they're going to be doing this as a way of building their future. Stay with us. We're going to come back. We're going to talk about more of those 8 reasons and the other real reasons. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Brexit Independence Day. We're going to play a clip from Nigel Farage, I think is excellent, talking about the failing EU. This is the man who is the voice crying in the wilderness. Remember, we've had him on many, many times years ago on the Alex Jones Show. We had all these videos that many of you may remember where he was hectoring Herman Van Rompuy, telling him that he had the manner of a third-rate bank clerk and other things like that. But he was absolutely right to be outraged that the European Union would come in and just dictate to Greece what they wanted to do. I mean, here you've got the cradle of democracy, Greece. And their European Union comes in and says, we're going to throw out your elected people. We're going to put in our own bankers in charge of your country. Okay? That's what they did. So we're going to play that clip. Before we do, real quickly, I want to let you know about a new sale that just came out today. Deep Cleanse, our fastest-selling InfoWars Life supplement. And it's not really a supplement. It's a way to cleanse your body of toxins. It has 5 instead of 5, 6, or 7 different cleansers for your body, this is an all-in-one, as we call it, our Rolls-Royce all-in-one cleansing formula. It has concentrated zeolites, organic cilantro, organic milk thistle, fulvic acid, many other cleansing ingredients. And as I said, it's our fastest-selling formula. It is 20% off in our new special. That's at InfoWarsLife.com. Deep Cleanse, 20% off. Also, get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt, 50% off. Sign up for our newsletter and get a link to code for multiple second, third, however many you want to get, unlimited number, 75% off at that point of your Hillary for Clinton t-shirt. So you can get one at 50% off, sign up for our newsletter that's free, and get a code so that you can get 75% off as many as you would like after that. And we still have our 20% off all Alexa Pure water filters from the largest down to the smallest systems. I want to play that clip from Nigel Farage, and then we're going to go back and talk about how the BBC and the establishment still doesn't get it in their analysis of why people left. But let's play first Nigel Farage. He needs to get the last word on this.
Morning. The sun has risen on an independent United Kingdom. And just look at it. Even the weather's improved. It's been a hell of a long journey, this. I first got involved in Eurosceptic politics 25 years ago, and the first election I contested, I managed to beat the late, great, screaming Lord Such by 164 votes, so I didn't come last. And now there are 17 million people that voted for Brexit. It's a victory for ordinary people, decent people. It's a victory against the big merchant banks, against the big businesses, and against big politics. And I'm proud of everybody that had the courage, in the face of all the threats, everything they were told, they had the guts to stand up and do the right thing. I believe the other big effect of this election is not what's happened in Britain, but what will happen in the rest of Europe. I mean, in the rest of the EU, Eurosceptic parties never talked about leaving the EU. Now they are. An opinion poll in the Netherlands said that a majority there now want to leave. So we may well be close, perhaps, to Nexit. And similarly in Denmark, a majority there are in favour of leaving, so we could be quite close to Dexit. And I'm told the same may apply to Sweden and perhaps Austria and perhaps even Italy too. The EU's failing, the EU's dying. I hope we've knocked the first brick out of the wall. I hope this is the first step towards a Europe of sovereign nation states, trading together, neighbours together, friends together, but without flags, anthems, or useless old unelected presidents.
And without all of the niggling regulations that they impose upon everybody. He's absolutely right. It is going to set off a stampede. I believe that the European Union is going to unravel. But you have to understand, it is truly, as one of the writers pointed out earlier today, we talked about a confederacy of dunces. It's not only a conspiracy by the banks. And if Britain were to stand alone, and if these guys were not so incompetent, it truly would be and it is going to be a difficult fight, because they are going to do everything they can to rig the markets, to create instability. As Paul Joseph Watson said, to blame every problem, no matter how big or small, is going to be blamed on Brexit. But it is also, they're going to have to fight a rear guard as well, because they're going to see all these different countries. I believe that Sweden will be one of the first ones, and one of the ones that is most capable of doing it, and as well as feeding the desire of people for self-government. That is what's behind this. That was what was behind the American Revolution, the desire of self-determination. Donald Trump has tapped into that. He spoke about that. When we come back, we're going to tell you why that is important, and we're going to take a look at what's next. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking about Brexit. I was talking in the last segment or so about the BBC giving 8 reasons why they thought that Brexit had succeeded. And of course, it was things like they just didn't believe how dire the economic consequences are going to be. No, they understand that. They understand there's going to be some painful adjustments going through this. But I think they also understand, there's economists who are pointing this out. I'm not the only one saying this. They had a well-respected economist who supported Brexit saying, as George Soros was talking about how this is going to be a Black Friday for currency markets, for stock markets, he said, hey, This is something that has made the Chinese rich. Yeah, let me give you some financial advice here. Get close to the radio. I'm going to whisper this to you because this is really key. You need to understand this, okay? If you want to get your country rich, then you don't buy stuff from other people. You sell it to them. And the way you do that is you have a cheap currency that works. It worked for China. It worked so well for China that we talk about currency manipulation and how unfair that is and how that needs to be controlled. That's part of the China price, along with stealing copyrights and things like that, okay? But manipulating their currency to make foreign products expensive so that you develop an internal manufacturing base, so that you buy products from each other within your country, and then making your products that you create in your country cheaper so that other people can buy them. That's how you grow your economy. That's how you build things. Now, let's say the opposite that we're constantly told by these free traders is that the way you become wealthy is you live off of the slave labor of other people. They say, well, you know, free trade. And I said, the naivete of this, when I watched Gary Johnson in the libertarian debates, a perfect example. If you want to see the naivete of what passes for free trade, which is really nothing but crony capitalism and the path to destruction for your economy, is the way Gary Johnson put this. And of course, I've heard this economic argument, and so have you, I'm sure. Well, hey, if China wants to make free stuff for us with their slaves and just sit back and enjoy all the goodies. Well, what's happened with that giant sucking sound, okay? It sucked down all of our industry. And we're getting to the point where when we just coast and when we live off of the fat of other people, the labor of other people, eventually we get to a point where we don't have any more wealth to spend, okay? Because we don't have an income. And the same thing is coming with the robots. Understand the progression of this free trade thing, this lie that we've been told, this globalist scheme that we've been sold. Understand that the first thing that happens is your manufacturing economy disappears and you wind up with a service economy. We were told, oh, that's great. All those stinky industries and everything, you know, that's great. All those polluters, you know, they're not going to be in our country. They're going to be in China. And we're going to just have clean service industries where we take in each other's laundry. Yeah, okay, that's fine. Except that the reality of it is that doesn't make much money and it doesn't produce anything. You have to have a manufacturing base because that's where true wealth is produced, is when you're producing things of value. And then the next logical extension of this, which Gary Johnson went on to, he said, oh, and then, you know, Uber, that's the model for everything, the Uber economy, Uber everything, he said. It's like, what an idiot. So you're going to go from a manufacturing economy to a service economy to a gig economy, a gig economy. How does that gig economy work? Well, you know, there's an article from the Drudge Report today, via the Drudge Report from CBS News, and they're talking about what a bad deal Uber is for the employees. They say Uber is coming under increased scrutiny after leaked documents indicate their drivers really don't make much money at all. They say the next thing you know, when you sign up for Uber, there's thousands of drivers. It's taking forever for you to get a ride. In other words, get a customer. So that's why when things started getting bad, I started organizing drivers so we could have a voice, okay? And they said the Uber driver's at the mercy of the rate the company is setting for that ride. Look, understand that this is just a temporary gig, okay? And temporary in every sense of the word. The CEO of Uber has said all along, what makes our rides so expensive is that other dude in the car with you, the driver, and we want to get rid of him as soon as possible and have self-driving cars, and we want private cars to go away. And as I pointed out a couple of weeks ago, there's an article on the Daily Mail's automotive section where they went through and they said, how many miles a year are the British soccer moms driving to ferry their kids around? And what would that cost as a taxi fare? They were to buy taxi drives or Uber drives with that. And I thought, boy, that's a really, they stumbled onto something here. They weren't putting it in the context of what's going to happen when we no longer own private cars. But let me tell you something. You couldn't afford to do that. It's going to radically alter your lifestyle, especially when Uber is not just setting the price that they pay for their drivers from a monopoly position, but when Uber is Uber all transportation, which is their goal, when they have connections to government to operate as a full-on crony capitalist, and they have a monopoly of transportation, then you as a passenger will get the monopoly pricing. And it is going to cost you a fortune. It is going to control your transportation. And so, and then where are you going to get your job? Remember, this is where this progression goes. You go from having a high-paying manufacturing job where you're creating something and you're creating wealth to a service economy where you're just kind of moving things back and forth and doing each other's laundry to the gig economy. And the next step is no job, no job. And how do you control these unruly people, the precariat, they call them at Bilderberg? Well, when you've replaced them with robots, with the self-driving cars, or with, and this is another story that was up on Drudge Report, Silicon Valley's robot pizzeria, you know, you're not even going to have jobs making pizza. You're not going to have jobs at the bottom. You're not going to have jobs at the middle or at the top. They're going to be using robots to replace everybody at every level in every industry. This is vertical. It is horizontal. It is deep. It is wide. It is going to be massively disruptive across all industry, across all social strata, and every economic group. So what happens when you put everybody out of work and nobody can afford to buy anything anymore? Well, you give them a universal basic income, which is, that's their solution. Put everybody on welfare and then do a soft kill. As you're looking at this broadcast, you're seeing the wonderful robot pizza. Maybe the other robots will be able to afford the pizza. No, they're going to give you a universal basic income to keep you quiet, to then do a soft kill on you. And we've seen this type of thing happening as our own federal government, using Agenda 21, is shutting down industry and the logging industry and the mining industry and the ranching industry, as they're taking people's property, but put them on welfare for a while, and then they take that welfare off. This is where this is headed. People are understanding where this is heading now. It's very important that people are understanding this. Let's take a look at these last four reasons that the BBC was giving us for why the Brexit won. First, let's review here. They said Brexit economic warnings backfired. In other words, people didn't believe it. They saw it as fear-mongering. They said, well, you know, they actually believed this figure of £350 million. And so they put a lot of time and effort to try to say, well, that number is not real, or it is real, or this. Look, they understand there is a big net flow going out of the country, and they don't have any control as to how big that ultimately is going to be. And it's money going out of the country that's being spent on things they don't like. They have no control over. They say Farage made immigration the defining issue. I said, no, the EU made that the defining issue. Then the next thing that they had here was to say that the public had stopped listening to the prime minister. The authorities, the political authorities, the mainstream media, which was consistently on the show. I was listening to this last night, and one of the things that was so entertaining and joyful and watching what otherwise most people would think, I guess, is kind of dry, political junkie. But watching the BBC, giving the returns and everything, and watching all these commentators on the BBC, you would have thought that Princess Diana had died or something equivalent to that had happened again. They were so long-faced. It was just the end of their world. End of their world. And it is. They understand. They did everything they could. They have absolutely no influence or credibility with the people in England, and they don't have it here in America. And that's the important thing as we move forward into our election, where we have our vote on Independence Day, where we're going to get independent from the globalists, from the multinational corporations that are trying to push us down into a soft kill welfare state by taking all of our jobs, going from manufacturing to service to gig to nothing, to welfare. That's the progression. They go on to say labor failed to connect with voters. Of course they did. They know what has happened. They've experienced this. It's an experience. It isn't a, well, what if happened? They are operating from experience. They've seen how this is happening. And it's the labor leaders understand. And the same thing I think is going to happen here in America. The Democrats are out of touch with their voters. And this is the thinking Bernie voters are going to understand that they're being betrayed. The Democrat leadership is betraying their base, just like the Republican leadership is. But there's nobody on the Democrat side. What you've got is an insider running on the Democrat side who's going to continue to betray you, who's going to continue to sell you down the river and shut down your factories, shut down your mining operations, shut down your economy, take your jobs, and that's Hillary Clinton. She is the Wall Street candidate. It's absolutely unbelievable to hear Bernie Sanders say, I'm going to vote for Hillary because we got to do something about the big money interests. She is the Wall Street candidate, folks. I mean, all week, the beginning of the week, what did we hear? This continuing narrative about, oh, Donald Trump hasn't raised any money, but look at all the money that Hillary Clinton got from foreign governments and Wall Street and so forth and so on. Isn't that wonderful? These are the people who are constantly complaining, and rightfully so, when George W. was buying the election, saying there's too much money in politics. No, there's too much power in Washington is really what the issue is. You wouldn't have that money in politics if you didn't have the power in Washington to make all of these decisions that they should not have the power to do, that they don't have the legal authority to do. And this is the key, folks. When we look at what's going on with Brexit, it really is about the sovereignty. The issues of the economy are secondary. And I pointed this out briefly on Wednesday. This June 20th article from the Washington Post really laid it out. They say this Brexit vote could lead to the destruction of one of the most ambitious political projects. It's not an economic project, first and foremost. First and foremost, it was designed to be a political project. The most ambitious political project since the Holy Roman Empire, okay? And you got to understand, it has the ambition to be a world government, a key piece of the world government. I was explaining to my daughter last night how they created the European bloc. They created the North American trading bloc. These are economic groups as well as Asian trading companies. They created these conglomerations of countries and said, this is about free trade. This is about economics. Okay, no, their ultimate goal was political. Their ultimate goal is political. And they will use the economic power that they have and the pressure of saying, well, if you get out, your economy is going to collapse. You can't go it on your own. Look, Britain has a far more diversified economy with far more people in it, energy independence, all of these things, far better shape than they ever were before, ever were at any time. Any of these countries could go it on their own. You don't have to live and die by export-import. You can be self-sufficient. Every one of these countries are huge. Probably most of them have a stronger, more diverse economy within themselves than they did as all of Europe 100 years ago. But let's talk about Washington Post's analysis of this. They say, at the moment, the list of countries that might consider to be bolting would be short. France, Denmark, the Netherlands, a handful of others. No, it's much longer than that. They downplay that. They say, but the days in which leaders convened in Brussels to hand over even more sovereignty to the EU may be over if Britain departs. Now, that's the key point. They've been meeting in Brussels to hand over sovereignty. And they were saying, we have the flag, we have the anthem, we don't have much of what supports that flag and that anthem. In other words, they want more political control. As one guy said, we thought, as he pointed to the founding fathers of the European Union, said the founding fathers thought they were like medieval alchemists. They thought they could transform the stone of economic integration into the gold of political integration. That was always the goal, political integration, okay? That has always been the end game with this, political integration. It's always been a political move. It's always been about self-government. And that is what's so dangerous about it. Let me just run down these eight real reasons why they should have left and why they did leave. The first one, again, is that £350 million per week. These are Boris Johnson's reasons, okay? £350 million per week, more to spend as Brits wish, spending it on their priorities. And I pointed out when I did this comparison, I said, hey, in Texas, it's about $1.5 billion a week. Now, you can quibble over the numbers. The bottom line is, why should we be sending more money to Washington than we get back? Because what do we get back from them? Well, we get massive amounts of regulations, okay? We get a jurisdiction of a court that interferes in our lives. He put it this way. He said, in Britain, they'd be able to get out from underneath the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice, increasingly arbitrating in questions that we never thought it would become involved in, even going down into the family, into the right of the child. What's happening with our Supreme Court? The same thing. They're expanding their powers. They are taking power that was never theirs. And this is why it is so important that we don't move to the next level. They have created these economic blocks in Europe and North America, these trading blocks and in Asia. They're trying to consolidate those now with America as the spine. Okay, and the two wings would be the European Union and the Asian trade. And the way that they're going to connect those wings to the spine are with these trade agreements, the transatlantic and the transpacific, if they do that. And that has been the plan and the way they viewed the world and the steps towards global consolidation. It's been the overt plan of the Trilateral Commission since Mika Brzezinski's dad wrote the plan and then became the first president of the Trilateral Commission. Let's create these economic blocks in these three areas, and then we will gradually make them more political. Then we will create another economic trade treaty to link the three of them together through the United States, and then we will assert political control over the entire world. Now, what's happening is that one of their blocks is starting to unravel, and it is a worldwide movement. Here, they've got a maverick who came out of nowhere, Donald Trump, who has opposed for 30 years these globalist trade agreements like NAFTA, okay, which has had deleterious effects here in the U.S., just as the European Union has had bad economic effects there, has opened up our borders, just as the European Union has opened up our borders. And he said, that's enough. It's a bad deal, and we're not going to go the next step. Now, they're saying they're going to try to run this through before Obama leaves office. Well, we'll see about that. We'll see about that, whether they do that or not. I don't think that'll happen. But he goes on to say, we'd be free to do our own free trade agreements. If we stay, they will drag us ever farther into a federal structure that will support this fiat currency that is absolutely worthless. The same thing is happening here. This is a movement of self-government. When we come back, we're going to talk about the other side of this and the face of this. This article that was on the Drudge Report today, there are now more bureaucrats with guns than there are U.S. Marines. It is a standing army. They're standing there with guns pointed at your head. They are writing the laws without your input, and they have their own courts and their own army. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to be joined in the next hour. Anthony Gucciardi is going to be hosting our fourth hour, and he's going to have Dr. Group as one of his guests. He's going to have a couple of different guests to talk about health issues. Along that line, we have a new special at InfoWarsLife.com, 20% off Deep Cleanse. You might want to use 5, 6, or even 7 cleansers to do what this one cleanser, this all-in-one cleanser, the Rolls Royce of cleansers that we sell, can do. And, of course, it combines the power of concentrated zeolites, organic cilantro, organic milk thistle, fulvic acid, many other cleansing ingredients. We thank you for your support, and we offer these kinds of sales because we want this to be a win-win for you as well. We try to create the best products that we can, and we do that. You can read the reviews, the hundreds of five-star reviews, and this is one of our fastest-selling formulas that we have at InfoWarsLife.com. On sale right now, 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Deep Cleanse, 20% off. Also, if you want to spread the news, start the revolution for our independence. It's going to be, we're going to have that vote coming up first Tuesday in November. We're going to vote on whether or not we want to be independent of the globalists, because this is a global war against us. You can get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt to spread the news, 50% off. And if you sign up for our free newsletter, you'll get a code for 75% off additional t-shirts. And also, we still have the 20% off Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. If you don't have clean water, you're in trouble. You need to make sure water is the most essential thing. You can go for a while without food, but you can't go long at all without water, and you need to have clean water. Whether you're on a well or whether you're on a municipal water supply, we've got 20% off all the filters from the largest gravity-fed all the way down to shower filters that are going to take out things like chlorine, so you don't get chlorine gas when you put that hot water in your shower. So all those Lexapure water filters are 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, suddenly when we came back, I wanted to talk about this article that's on the Drudge Report from the Washington Free Beacon. There are now more bureaucrats with guns than there are U.S. Marines. Remember, the greatest danger to our country that our founders saw was that of a standing army. They wanted the community to have the power. That's what posse comitatus means, folks. Think of the Old West movies where you've got the sheriff and he's got one or two deputies that are always there. These are the professionals, the people who are going to be the leaders. We had a professional military corps that was always going to be there that would lead the people if our country was invaded by enemies, foreign or domestic. But the real power was in the community. The militia was to be trained on how to use firearms. They were to have their own firearms ready at the readily available, just like they do in Switzerland. The power was supposed to be in the community. They said standing armies have always become means of oppression at home. The means of our defense abroad have become the tools of tyranny at home, to paraphrase Madison. So they created the Second Amendment. That's what it's fundamentally about. It's not about hunting. It's not even fundamentally about self-defense on a personal level. Those are obvious legitimate uses, but it is fundamentally about making sure that the power resides in the community instead of a professional standing army. But we've gone one step further than that, something that is even worse than that. There are now more non-military government employees who carry guns than there are U.S. Marines. They point out in this Washington Free Beacon story, Open the Books, which is a taxpayer watchdog group, released a study Wednesday, that finds domestic government agencies continue to grow their stockpiles of military-style weapons as Democrats hold their sit-in, calling for more restrictions on the guns that you can buy, okay? They call this the militarization of America. $1.4 billion spent on guns and ammunition. We talked about that. We're the ones who broke, Paul Joseph Watson broke the massive purchases of ammunition. Everybody said, oh, you're fear-mongering. There's nothing wrong with that. We'll talk about that when we come back right after the top of the hour. And Anthony Gucciardi is going to be with us in the fourth hour. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. This final segment, I'll be with you. And then Anthony Gucciardi will be here with Dr. Group for the fourth hour. As I was talking in the last segment about this article about there's now more bureaucrats with guns than there are U.S. Marines. Okay. Now, this is something, if you remember the phrase taxation without representation, what does that mean to you? I mean, that was a key part of what was going on with Brexit yesterday. They understood that they were not well represented. They weren't being listened to. There wasn't any transparency. There wasn't any control of Brussels. They wanted government closer to them, more easily controlled. And certainly it's not perfect. I think the national governments have gotten far too large. They try to control far too large political segments. I think it's going to have to get much smaller if anything's going to get any better. But there's a start. And if we let our government be subsumed into a world government, we're not even going to have the basis to appeal to the Constitution. But what started the American Revolution? What was one of the major griefs they had with Brexit? And that was taxation without representation. There's also regulation without representation. How does that look in our country? Well, it looks like these bureaucracies that we don't elect, that persist regardless of who becomes president, whether it's a Republican or a Democrat, these permanent unelected bureaucracies continue to write our rules. They continue to tax us with those rules. They drag us into their courts, not the real courts. They call these civil actions so that we have no due process. You understand that, right? That's one of the key issues with the drug war. Civil asset forfeiture. They say, oh, no. We're going to just take your property, your car, your boat, your plane, your house. We're going to say that it was involved somehow tangentially in a drug deal. We're not going to charge you with anything. So it's not a criminal action, so you don't have any due process. But this is a civil action. So if you want to get your property back, you're going to have to come up with the money to sue us. You're going to sue us to get your property back. They do the same thing with eminent domain. We're seeing that happening now here in Texas. And so this is the way the bureaucracies operate. They level fines, massive fines, ridiculous, excessive fines against you. But they say, oh, no, it's just a civil action. It's not a criminal action. So all these constitutional protections don't apply. It's total nonsense. It's just a lie. And we need to call it for what it is. But they have essentially created their own laws, their own courts, where you have no presumption of innocence, where you have no due process, and they have their own army. Their own army of law enforcement people. This report that came out of Open the Books says the militarization of America, that's the name of the report, the militarization of America report found civilian agencies spent $1.5 billion on guns, ammunition, military-style equipment between 2006 and 2014. Examples include IRS agents with AR-15s, EPA bureaucrats wearing camouflage. You know, there was several years ago, the Washington Post did a story saying, wait a minute, we just saw an RFP, just like we pointed out these RFPs about requests for purchase, about all the massive ammunition purchases. And he said, wait a minute, this is a massive quantity of bullets that are being bought. This is not for target practice. This is equivalent to several years worth of ammunition expenditures in the Iraq War. What's going on with these people? And furthermore, These are hollow point bullets, which are outlawed even for the military to use. But of course, governments can use them against their own people, designed to do the maximum amount of damage. And of course, the military makes its own bullets, but Homeland Security and these bureaucracies were buying them out of the marketplace and creating havoc inside the marketplace. Nobody could get ammunition for their own weapons. Okay, they were sucking up all the supply. And so they point out regulatory enforcement within these administrative agencies now carries the might of military-style equipment and weapons. They say there's 200,000 non-military federal officers with arrest and firearm authority. There's only 182,000 Marines. That's the danger that we have in this unaccountable, non-transparent government that is coming at us. Taxation without regulation, without representation, regulation without representation.
That's right. It's the Alex Jones Show, and I'm Anthony Gucciardi. This is the fourth hour of Overdrive. David Knight did such a great job today listening to the show. He's so on point and really knows what he's talking about. Now it's time for me. And whether or not I know what I'm talking about, we do have a lot of talk to about today. We've got two guests. I wasn't going to bring Dr. Group on first, but he called me and he said, hey, I've got some really, really big news. I have to come on the show, please, today on the fourth hour. So he's going to join us for about 5 or 10 minutes and break down some really, really interesting stuff. And then we've got a fellow named James Knox, who's going to come on at the bottom of the hour. And he is a very, very interesting character with a military background in engineering, a lot of knowledge on the internet and its functions. We're going to talk about, if you guys remember, the old internet kill switch. So in 2011, it was announced that the internet kill switch was approved by Homeland Security, a Senate committee, the idea that they could just shut down the internet and end free speech on the internet and things like CISPA and all that. Well, we're going to talk to Mr. Knox about his background in engineering a lot of military infrastructure for internet-related stuff and what he thinks about the internet kill switch and why he thinks that it may not be so easy and that we may have pretty much free reign and access on the internet for a long, long time to come, no matter what happens and what corrupt entities try to mess with it. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to go to Dr. Group here in about 2 seconds. And we're going to talk about vitamin D and sunshine because I was out on the lake a little bit ago and I generally am a vampire for most of the year. But of course, I want to put on some organic sunscreen, right, so I don't get burned. But what people do is they spray the really, really terrible sunscreen and they think they're keeping themselves safe and they don't get any sun and they get no vitamin D and it's an insane thing that goes down when they're giving themselves cancer with these chemicals, trying to prevent cancer from the sun. It's a really, really insane situation. But Dr. Group, you called me today. You wanted to come on and talk about this. What's on your mind? And thanks for joining.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. It's always good to be on. I mean, it's summertime right now, and I see parents slathering sunscreen on their kids, slathering sunscreen all over the place. The dermatologists are telling people that they need to apply sunscreen to the face, to the body, 2 times a day. And what's happening is we're in an epidemic right now with vitamin D deficiency, and vitamin D deficiency is one of the root causes for the majority of diseases that are out there. But I've really had a lot of research requests lately into skin cancer and is sunscreen actually safe to use? You know, we've been telling people don't put on chemical sunscreen for a long period of time. The sun produces 2 different types of rays, the UVB rays and the UVA rays. And it's interesting if you trace it back, because you know how I like to do the research and try to figure out, is there really a conspiracy behind this sunscreen or is there some plan? Well, there is, if you look back into the late 1960s and when sunscreen was first coming about, there really wasn't that many cases of skin cancer before the 1960s. And still to this day, if you look at the countries that are along the equator where the sun is the hottest and the rays are the strongest, they have practically 0 cases of skin cancer. So tracing it back as to how were sunscreens marketed, how were they developed, the American Dermatology Association teamed up with some pharmaceutical companies and individual manufacturers and was spending $1 billion a year and fear campaigns to try to convince people that the sun was bad. I mean, the sun is the source of all life. If it's not for the sun, nothing could survive. Yet we have a society right now that believes that the sun is bad. And
the sun is bad and air is bad. Everything is bad for you that is natural, right?
Yeah, everything is
bad. Obviously, everything in moderation. You don't want to go out. You're going to get sunburned. It's terrible for you. Clearly, I've gotten sunburned. But there are people that are so afraid of the sun that they refuse to go out in the sun at all without like SPF 500 sunscreen on. I have people tell me that all the time. Well, don't go out into the sun. That's bad for you. You get skin cancer. What do you mean don't go out in the sun? How do you think we got this far as a race? Do you think we just stayed in our huts forever and we never went outside one time? Clearly, the sun has so many different benefits, not even just the vitamin D, but the different rays that hit you and the way your body absorbs and everything like that. People have been told, though, that it is evil. It's like the root of all evil. They've been told that over and over again.
Yeah, the strange thing is, though, if you look at the difference between the UVB and the UVA rays, the UVB are actually the rays that you need to produce vitamin D in your body, and that's from usually 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the afternoon. The UVA rays are the penetrating rays. Those penetrate past the epidermis, so the UVA rays... Both can be dangerous, don't get me wrong. The UVB, I say UVB for burning, you know, that because that will burn your skin fairly rapidly. And when your skin becomes burned, it is bad. But the UVB rays are also the essential rays that we need for vitamin D production. The UVA rays, though, are the dangerous, dangerous rays that penetrate all the way through the epidermis of the skin. Those are the ones that penetrate through your windows, actually, and can cause skin damage, and those are the ones that are associated with the majority of cancers. Well, guess what? The sunscreens that they didn't want to produce sunscreens that would block both of those rays. All the sunscreens out there block the UVB rays, the ones that are necessary for vitamin D production, and they don't even block the UVA rays. The UVA rays are the ones that cause skin cancer.
Well, that's very helpful.
They knew that was going to take place because they wanted more dermatologist visits. And actually, since the introduction of sunscreen, by the way, dermatologist visits have gone up exponentially 10 times since the 70s. And since the introduction of sunscreen, there's been more cancer, more skin allergies, more skin reactions than ever before in the history of the world. So my advice to everybody out there, and what I really wanted to let people know today, is don't listen to this false information that's being spread out there. You need vitamin D. That's why I've been on the show talking about the importance of vitamin D before, and that's why we developed the winter sun. It's really hard to even get vitamin D. There's been studies that have been done on lifeguards now that are out in the sun all day long. Yes, they're probably wearing sunscreen. That's one of the reasons why, but they're still deficient in vitamin D.
So basically, people are putting sunscreen on. They're going out in the sun for a short period of time. I see people do this all the time. Spray themselves down with the sunscreen, go out in the sun for maybe like 5 or 10 minutes. They're not even getting the rays they need to create the vitamin D in the first place. And then they're vitamin D deficient, but they go out in the sun all day. They have a tan. So they think, oh, I get so much vitamin D, because 15 minutes is like 15,000 IU of vitamin D in the sun. If you can produce it in your body naturally, you don't have the sunscreen on. But then they go in and they get tested. You know, I get my blood tested routinely for trace minerals and vitamins and stuff. And they always say, wow, you're like the only person ever to have high vitamin D levels. I say, well, this is Austin, Texas. People go out in the sun. And they say, yeah, but everyone has sunscreen on. No one goes out without sunscreen ever. They put it all over their face. And I'm definitely not saying don't use sunscreen. I mean, use it for sure, especially if you can be out in the sun for a long time. But you can at least go for 5 minutes. You can at least go for 5 minutes in the sun and get some real sun on your skin before you slather on all the sunscreen and get the vitamin D. Right? Or use a supplement or something, because it's better to get some vitamin D for 5 minutes of evil, evil sun exposure. You know, the very evil, evil sun that we've all been programmed to hate and fear so deeply. It's actually good for you, clearly in moderation. And, you know, don't know all the statistics about everything, but vitamin D prevents cancer deeply. So there it is.
Yeah, and the thing is that if you pick up a bottle of sunscreen, I actually went to the store a couple days ago and just looked at the pharmacy, and it is amazing the amount of chemicals and phthalates and endocrine-disrupting chemicals. Oxybenzone is one of the ones, avobenzone, all of the same ingredients in sunscreens. There's probably 20 or 30 toxic cancer-causing endocrine-disrupting chemicals in every sunscreen that's out there. They're probably one of the worst things. The skin is the largest organ. You're outside, you're in the heat, your skin cells open up, your pores open up, and all those chemicals go directly into your bloodstream. They bypass the detoxification of the liver and ultimately can cause all kinds of problems. They're estrogen mimickers. They can cause obesity. They can cause problems with your hormones, allergies, tumors, digestive system problems. And not only that, sunscreens contain high levels of fragrance, and you know fragrance is the hidden word for phthalates, and fragrances can contain up to 1,500 different
toxic chemicals. It means nothing, yeah. It's just a catch-all term for everything, just like, you know, certain natural things. So in closing, Dr. Group, thanks for coming on the show. This is really important because everyone's gone out in the summer now, and they're getting sun, lathering up the sunscreen, especially the spray nanoparticulates, the sunscreen.
And I have some natural solutions, by the way.
Yeah, so what is your answer for this? What is the solution, in your view, to fight this?
So the solution is to switch to natural organic sunscreens, and there are some available, which are paraben-free, fragrance-free, vegan, phthalate-free, that don't have any of those toxic cancer-causing chemicals in there. Another thing that you can do, which has been used for centuries, is just wear a light, white, cotton long sleeve shirt. Cotton has a natural SPF factor of about 25. Be responsible in the sun, like what you were talking about, Anthony. Go out, you know, don't let yourself get burned. Put a natural sunscreen on, but also allow yourself to get some. And there's two oils that I really like. One of them is carrot seed oil, and the other one is red raspberry seed oil. Both of those, believe it or not, are tremendously beneficial for skin health, anti-aging, and they both naturally have an SPF factor of 28.
Right on.
So
excellent.
Using
well,
some
Dr.
of those,
Group, we
and then
head
drink
to break.
Lots of water.
Excellent advice. Thank you so much for coming on, and everyone really needs to listen to this. This summer, the sun is strong. We'll be right back. This is the Alex Jones Show. Coming back with Little Led Zeppelin. They just won a court case that they own the rights to the beginning of Stairway to Heaven. Interesting case. So, you know, this is the Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi, and there's been a lot of talk about Brexit today. And last night when it was declared that Britain did, in fact, cast their votes and they wanted to leave the EU, you know, everyone's saying Brexit, 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 you know, analyzing certain factors of it, the monetary values and everything like that. But wait a minute. What is the EU? So here's an article that I saw today just before I came on the show. What is the EU? Trends on Google in the UK as the country votes for Brexit. So this is the second biggest trend right now. Second top question in the UK. What is the EU? That's what people in the UK are searching for right now on Google. The second top question. What is the EU? Says... This is from CNET. The UK has brought the Brexit debate to a clear resolution. The country has voted to leave the European Union. But while 72% of Britons who have cast their vote appear to have done so with confidence, their search histories tell another story. Thanks to Google Trends data, it's possible for us to see what doubts and questions voters typed into the search engine in the privacy of their own homes. Not all of them inspire a vote of confidence. Others are telling of the reactions and concerns with the British public now that Brexit is a reality. So it says, some of the frequently asked questions cropping up in Google from within the UK include, quote, what is the EU? And, quote, what happens if we leave the EU? The former was the second top UK question on the EU after the results were officially announced. The latter saw more than a 250% spike after the polls closed. So maybe we shouldn't be talking about Brexit. Maybe we should get back to what is the European Union? What is the United States of America? What is this planet we're on? What is this world? Where am I? What is my name? How do I eat food? How do I breathe air? Am I in this galaxy? Are there aliens here? Am I a dog? These are all questions we should be asking instead of talking and pontificating about the results of Brexit and the implications on the global policy and economics and all that. We should be asking, what planet am I even on? Am I a dog? I mean, these are the questions. What is the EU? All right, we got to get back to the basics here, guys. We're getting ahead of ourselves. And I bring this up as a little humor, too. And also one of search queries was how to move to Canada in the UK after the European Union vote. But I bring this up because I want to highlight a point. Truth is that a lot of the time, people don't listen to the details. And if you've ever heard me host the show before, you know I always say, we always lose because we don't pay attention to the details. We're a headline society. We read the headlines. We ask if we are on this planet, if what is the EU. But we read headlines. We don't get into the details. We don't get into the crux of the matter, the research, the actual information. What happens is we kind of let things slide with, for example, on the internet with CISPA and SOPA and all that. Everything just restricting everything. The big banks coming in, eluding stuff. We kind of just let it happen. And then we get mad, though, when the results come in. It reminds me of this article. IMF warns the U.S. over high poverty. The U.S. has been warned about its high poverty rate in the International Monetary Fund's annual assessment of the economy. The fund said about 1 in 7 people were living in poverty and that it needed to be tackled urgently. It recommended raising the minimum wage and offering paid maternity leave to women to encourage them to work. The report also cut the country's growth forecast from 2016 to 2.2% from a previous prediction of 2.4. So the IMF is warning, hey, United States, you're in poverty. 1 in 7 people are living in poverty. Something has to be done about it. Well, what did we do? And I understand that, you know, listeners of this show are informed. They look at the details, and a lot of people do. But in general, what happens as a society? We're all guilty of this. I do this too. I mean, I'm busy. We let things slide. We let certain corporations and banks and organizations loot the economy. We let certain groups attack internet freedom. We let certain groups, like example of this article here, cable companies overcharging millions and millions of dollars to customers without even realizing it. I mean, we're just getting attacked on all fronts, and we're tired, we're upset, and we're kind of just letting it happen. And the end result is 1 in 7 are in poverty. So instead of us saying, wow, we need to go back and look at all those details about the bankers that did these things to the economy, $183 billion or whatever more it is now in taxpayer profits to the banks, how they got away with that. No one went to prison. Wow, that's crazy. But instead of saying that, we come and say, higher minimum wage. We're upset. Do something about it. No, guys, we got to fix the root cause. When the boat is filling up with water, don't just, I don't know, dump gasoline in it. You got to hole up the boat, man. You got to fix the boat. All right, we'll be right back. We've got a guest talking about the internet kill switch and internet freedom. So let's go back to 2010. A lot of you are going to remember this. The internet kill switch, the notorious, the nefarious internet kill switch. And here's an article from the Huffington Post. Internet, quote, kill switch approved by Senate Homeland Security Committee. The Senate Committee on Homeland Security and Governmental Affairs has approved a cybersecurity bill protecting cyberspace as a national asset act that would give the president far-reaching authority over the internet in the case of an emergency. As The Hill explains, the bill, sponsored by Senator Joe Lieberman, Susan Collins, and Tom Carper, would give the president, quote, emergency authority to shut down private sector or government networks in the event of a cyber attack capable of causing massive damage or loss of life. The original bill granted the president the authority to indefinitely shut down networks, but an amendment to the PCNAA approved yesterday mandates that the president get congressional approval after controlling a network for 120 days. The authority granted to the government in this bill has been likened to an internet kill switch. So first and foremost, I think most people watching this program or listening live on radio right now would agree the internet is really the epitome of free information flow. The internet is a truly amazing, beautiful thing. The internets, right? The series of tubes. And as a bastion of freedom and a bastion of free-flowing information, a just kind of lexicon of information, The internet, therefore, is, of course, a threat, a direct threat to certain groups and people, whatever it is, right? It's even a threat to individuals. You know, people can make up stuff about you all day long on the internet and put it out there, okay? But that's kind of the inherent beauty of it, isn't it? Right? It's just such an open forum, but not so much anymore as certain groups kind of close in on it. Now, we've got this individual, James Knox, here, and the producer said this would be a really, really good guest to talk about the internet kill switch because it's back in the news. I mean, remember, we've got not only CISPA, the zombie bill, the internet regulation bill, CISPA, just comes back from the dead over and over and over again. The, you know, meet the new CISPA, same as the old CISPA. It's all the same junk and SOPA and Homeland Security, working on the internet kill switch. It's just all this craziness. The internet really is a huge threat because it cannot be controlled. But James Knox, from his bio here, in 1984, James Knox joined the U.S. Army as part of the last class of 26Vs. He was honorably discharged in November of 1990. He worked as assistant COSMEC custodian, ran ARFCOS, lethal force authorized transport of theater. Basically, he has a lot of military background, and he is an engineer. He has done networks encompassing wireline to microwave to fiber optics for both commercial and government clients. And what I wanted to talk to him about and ask him about is the regulation of the internet kill switch, all of the craziness going on with the internet right now, and what kind of systems are in place for that, and if it were even possible for, let's say, a group to say, oh, we're going to go ahead and turn the internet off. I mean, it's not even a reality in my view, but I'd like to hear his take. So, James, are you with us?
Yeah, absolutely. And you got to excuse my voice. We were doing a little yelling at bad guys yesterday. Early addiction training, and the hoarseness kicked in on me.
Are you all right?
Yeah, I'm fine. Just as long as you can hear me.
Well, I can hear you. Yep, I can hear you. I'm sorry that happened to you.
No problem.
Well, gee, you know, I heard that you live out there in California on a very kind of sustainable property with a lot of your own stuff going on out there. So I'd imagine, you say a horse kicked you?
No, we were doing interdiction training.
Oh, okay.
Action shooting, and my voice is hoarse from training a bad guy.
Gotcha.
Basically, you know, what we do is we go out and set up, you know, you've got a course, and you've actually got, you know, hostages and bad guys, you know, and you engage those.
I gotcha. So you're doing some training. Okay, cool. So, hey, I wanted to get you on and ask you, because I know you're an engineer and you have a military background with networks on commercial and government levels and everything like that. Tell me about this internet kill switch that everyone's been talking about for years and years and years. Do you think it is a reality? You know, what is it in your view, this whole internet kill switch?
Well, if we look at, let me back up a second, just to say, let's look at the network as a whole. Okay, about 2000, the switch is in, you know, every central office in the state. Went there, and we'll use Lucent's equipment, went to what's called a 7RE switch. And that's an asynchronous switch, a packetized switch. So it becomes very much like the internet. But then what actually transports that is a synchronous network, which is mostly fiber and mostly SONET or SDH overseas. Now what this does, this takes a large pipe and breaks it up into smaller pipes. So the internet, you've got a pipe that, you know, you've got a branch off this tree that's 12 inches in diameter. And we'll say that 30% of that is internet traffic. But that's mixed in with 70% of other traffic. Okay, so all these things have to go to different geographic locations.
Right.
So if you were to think about a conversation, you know, if you were going to call from the bottom of the tree to the very smallest tip branch of the tree, you'd have to go through all these different hubs to complete that phone call, correct?
Right.
Okay, same thing for the internet. Now, in the internet, you've got geographically located routing places, a lot of which are going to be major hubs if you're using, like, UUNet fiber and things like that. If you look at the train that follows Route 66, that is one of the fiber legs that goes from coast to coast. Basically, there's two that are really, you know, we're talking big pipes. Now, again, you've got everything running over that. Now, that includes E911, a lot of DOT, a lot of that's private, but you've also had a lot of mixing of infrastructure. So, now, if you're understanding this synchronous pipe that has this asynchronous internet data on it, how are you going to turn that off? Okay, you have to go in and turn off just that portion of the bandwidth. So in order to do that, you need a switch. And you could use a layer 2 or a layer 3 managed switch to do that.
So what you're saying is it's all consolidated into two different massive fiber pipes. And all of these are going to different networks, and they're extremely complex. And when you say you need a switch, I mean, break that down for people for a moment, as in you need a switch. It's not a light switch, right? So yeah, what? How exactly would one have a so-called switch over these pipes?
That's where I'm going. So okay. If we're looking at this pipe, okay, and the president has this ability, he's got this authority, okay, in order to do that, that's just going to consist of a plan. And what you're going to have to do is go through and find all these geographical locations. Now, when we're talking a switch, we're not talking the Staples easy button. You know, the internet kill switch is not anything remotely close to the Staples easy button. You need a very broad scope plan and a great deal of integration and logistics and resources to know where these switches are. Now, when I say switch, that means that this internet traffic is going, you know, it leaves your machine, it's tied to an IP address, which is tied to your physical MAC address, and then it's basically like stuffing envelope with an envelope in order to tell that data packet where it needs to go. So in order to shut off the internet, you need to shut off all these different pipes. So, in other words, all these different switches or routers. You can look at a router like a switch. And a router is basically just a traffic cop. It says, you know, it sees a packet coming in. You know, it's taking the synchronous internet that has been pulled off, and that's being stuck into it, and then it's dividing that up and deciding where it needs to go.
Right. Now, okay. Now, a quick question for you. So, okay, we've got these massive fiber pipes. And you're saying clearly that's not just a switch, right? The so-called internet kill switch that the government has essentially mandated through these acts. Now, also, you're saying that all of this traffic is going somewhere. It's going through routers, which are directing the signals to the appropriate locations, and that the switch would essentially be, if I'm, you know, understanding right, a shutdown of across the board, the routers, everything, just basically all the infrastructure shutting down at one time. So it'd be a massive, massive, massive operation.
No, actually, the switch basically controls, let's say if you looked at and there was a picture that Alex had up with all those Ethernet connections in it. Each one of those ports is a switch. So each one is a circuit and each one is a switch. So you'd have to turn the router off. But what is that router transporting? You know, is it transporting just civilian internet, or is it transporting, you know, government internet? Who knows? So it may be so complex that you have to go in to all these different switches and specifically turn off groups of circuits in all kinds of places. Now, to turn off the internet as a whole, you could do that much easier by going to, like, the major hub, you know, the major network operations centers, say AT&T or any other large telco, and you can shut those points off, but that's not going to shut off local use. So if you think about America as a whole, try to shut everybody off. I mean, you know, just...
Yeah, it's pretty much not going to happen.
Just an OC-768 circuit, okay, which will travel over two pairs of glass or two pieces of glass that are smaller than a human hair. Now, that's transporting, if we're using, say, CW coarse width division multiplexing, we're able to take a multitude of 16, say, OC48 nodes and multiplex them on to those two pieces of glass.
So in other words, something smaller than a piece of hair is transmitting all this data. And even if they go ahead and shut down... And they, as in, you know, whatever group, let's say the government decides, oh, they need to do an internet kill switch operation. Okay. And like, and not saying that's going to happen, but under these bills, they do have the apparent ability to do so. They would go in and contact the major centers because it's consumer internet. You know, you're on your computer. You're not exactly rigging up your own system. You hired someone to come in like AT&T or Comcast or whatever and hook up your systems. So they would just essentially terminate your access. That's easy is what you're saying. But, of course, there's underground networks. You could set your own systems up. I mean, you could just get an Ethernet cable and connect to things. It's basically the concept of the internet is so inclusive and just ethereal that it's a silly thing to say all the internet's going to be shut down. But the consumer access points from AT&T and all these major telecom groups is what you're saying can be shut down pretty easily. Did I get that about right then?
Yeah, that's relatively close, and it could be done in a large group where they shut off the entire, you know, their entire revenue base, which they're not going to want to do because that's how they make money is revenue, or they can turn off specific ones. But you're still dealing with so many different geographical locations. Now, let's say they go and do that. Let's say they shut down the internet. So that we as civilians have no solid access. And what I mean by that, you know, you and I can't talk from Cali to Texas, say.
Right.
Well, okay, let's say screw them. And just screw them. Well, does everybody or does anybody remember a BBS? So guys like me or just a lot of normal people they know how to set up a BBS.
Bulletin board system.
They set up a bulletin board system, and then you start meeting people.
Yeah, and basically it'll bring you back to the very early days before the so-called adoption of the internet, right? Bulletin board systems where people can communicate and contact, which they really can't do anything about. So even if they shut down the central hub, there's nothing they can do. So we're about to jump to a break here. I just wanted to mention this article. So Homeland Security must disclose internet kill switch court rules. And to let you realize, this is the real deal. This is from Washington Times. The Department of Homeland Security must disclose its plans for a so-called internet kill switch. A federal court ruled on Tuesday. The United States District Court rejected agency's arguments that its protocols surrounding the internet kill switch, which are exempt from public disclosure. So in other words, they've got it figured out. And they are not exactly telling us all about it. So we'll be right back. Remember to check out InfoWarsLife.com for Deep Cleanse 20% off. We'll be right back with James Knox to talk more about internet censorship. You know, it's really inspirational to listen to during the break the callers that somebody back there, probably Rob Jacobson, put together all the callers that called in and talked about InfoWars Life and what the products did for them. The truth is, I am really passionate about things like Survival Shield X2, Nation Iodine, all these products were things that I had been using for a really long time before Alex even, you know, released them, testing them, seeing if they really worked. And the detoxing factors are real. It's all real. It's all legitimate. It's actually helping people deeply. It's not a joke. It's not some salesy con job. It is the real deal. And I put my word on that 100%. And, you know, I'm going to plug now because I heard that. At InfoWarsLife.com, you can get Deep Cleanse. It's 20% off right now. It's the all-in-one cleanser. It's been called the Rolls Royce of cleansing. You can have 5, 6, 7 different products that equivalent to, you know, basically the ingredients in Deep Cleanse. Organic ingredients that are the real deal. This is something that you can take in the morning. It does not require an extreme protocol. You don't have to do 7-day fast or something like that. You can just add this to your regimen. And it is a cleanser that you're going to feel. It really, really does work, but it's not super harsh. The point of Deep Cleanse is kind of like, okay, we have stuff like Liver Shield that you don't have to do the regimen, but a lot of people choose to do a 4 or 5, 6 day cleanse. And we have things that are like Survival Shield, Extinction Iodine, you know, a little bit easier. You can take every day. Deep Cleanse tries to put 5 or 6 different cleansing ingredients, product level ingredients, into one thing that really works. In my view, it's super easy to take. Check it out. It's 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. It's the fastest selling product. It sells out for weeks and months. It's the real deal. Now, anyway, James Knox, before we end the show, I want to get your take. We talked about the internet kill switch and the kind of logistics of it. Let's talk about internet censorship for a second. This article came out just about a week ago. Internet activists are finding ways around China's Great Firewall. It says, you know, it talks about basically people getting around the firewalls in various countries, escaping the censorship. In your view, what do you think is coming down the pipeline with internet censorship? And do you think that people that are internet activists and are against internet censorship are going to break free from it?
I think internet censorship is really an impossibility. I mean, you can certainly censor many things, but it's easy enough to break away from that. You know, if it got so bad, and just as an aside, I mean, if we could get the right money players, 98% of the fiber in the U.S. is black. We could build our own internet as a private network just by everybody buying into it. And then, you know, there's little they can do. But as far as censorship goes, I don't think they'll ever be able to pull it off. I mean, in my view, to censor the internet, there's too many back doors. I mean, you know, we could all start running Tor and Tails and basically go to the dark internet, which a lot of, they're probably not going to shut down.
Right. And I think also the backlash. Look at CISPA. They couldn't run these things through because we freaked out about it. We got upset about it because people deeply care about the internet, as they should. It is the bastion of freedom. It is an amazing, amazing thing. And it's a land of opportunity and free flow of information. James, thank you so much for joining. It's been really interesting talking to you and learning about this stuff. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Hi, this is the 4th hour of the Alex Jones Show. And Alex will be back Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. Central Standard Time. James, I apologize. I didn't mean to cut you off there. We're just about to head to break. So thanks again for joining. This is the real deal. Internet kill switch is a real thing. Thanks a lot.